Welcome to episode 130 of the Listen Up Podcast, where we analyze a new album each week. I'm Nick, and this week we've got me, Jamie.
I don't really love you anymore.
And Jordan.
Never nice to a peanut.
I should have said
this week we're taking a look at A Black Mile to the Surface by Manchester Orchestra, released in 2017. And really quick, if you want to keep up with the show, you can find us on Twitter at @listuppodcast and on Instagram and TikTok at @listenuppod. That's where we'll make any announcements regarding the show or merch. Speaking of which, if you'd like to support the show, you can find the merch at interestpointproductions.com or at the link tree on the socials. So regarding the selection for this week, Jamie, why did you choose this this album for us? This portrait of... I don't know. I don't really know a good word to describe it. Portrait of despair. That's a good
despairing
way.
Despairing mining town family.
Yep. Uh-huh. Gotta love nice Midwestern addiction and depression. It's really beautiful.
Is this Midwest emo or no?
A hell of a drug. No, it's emotional about the Midwest, but
okay.
It would be
Q Never Meant by, what is it? Modern Baseball.
Right, just play anything American, by the fucking Front
American
Bottoms
football?
Or American Football or Modern Baseball.
Modern Baseball and American Football? Why are those two so similar?
I think I made up Modern Baseball. Are they real?
No, I'm pretty sure Modern Baseball is a band. I thought that one was a real one.
They're a real band.
Yeah, I was going to say, I'm pretty sure that that's also a band. Yeah, no, literally. Dude, where's fucking futuristic soccer? There's also American Money, which is a different song, a different vibe. So this was an album that I've enjoyed for a while. When it came out, I was disappointed because I had just gotten into Cope and their other stuff before that, which is predominantly much more like rock driven music. Nowhere near as much like synth and like orchestration. It's like a lot. I mean, we've done Cope on the show. It's fucking.
Oh yeah.
I mean, it's angry. It is just mad rock and roll, which is what I wanted. Because this came out 2017 July. So it came out right after we graduated high school.
I never realized it was that old from 2017. It's not old, but I thought it was a couple years ago.
It's almost 6 years ago.
Yeah, and then I didn't realize they had 4 years between that and Cope, which is also kind of wild.
Yeah, because Cope was 2013, and then I got into Cope probably like halfway through high school, and then, Cope was episode 108, by the way, on YouTube, if I did my job. There's a little title card that appeared. I love Cope, and I was in the mindset where that's what I wanted this album to be. And it's not at all that. And so, like, I was initially disappointed. Because of that, I never checked it out more. I only ever really listened to The Gold on it. For The Gold and The Alien. And then, I don't know, probably, like, a year and a half ago or something, I just got into Manchester Orchestra again. I listened through all of their stuff. And when I listened to it this time, it, like, really resonated with me. The last time, and since then I've enjoyed it, but I haven't really taken the time to sit down and like look at the lyrics of what's being said. Like I catch bits and pieces here and there throughout the songs, but like I had no idea. I had just the sheer level of like thematic connection and songwriting there is throughout the whole thing.
There's no better way to start your Sunday scaries than analyzing an album about I guess I already kind of said Midwestern depression and addiction and despair and like philosophical questions that you can never find like a concrete answer to.
Dude,
and
it's
like
fucking crazy.
Failing love and, you know, like, you know, all the
tropes.
The hallmarks of the
good movie
experience.
Tropes.
Little butterflies in your tummy, you know. Warm and fuzzy.
I've intentionally set it up to where my blinds are open. So it's like I'm going into the light. I see the face of God.
Yeah. But believe it or not, this is the way I could get the least light coming through this window. And
I remember those fucking blinds. They look cool, but they don't do a whole lot.
Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah. But yeah, so I never really knew what the words are. And then I saw, so there's a guy I like on YouTube. His name's Michael Palazzano.
Michael Palazzano.
His channel is Guitargate, I think, like Watergate, but with a guitar. I don't know what it's a play on, but
he's leaking.
But he's like a really cool down to earth guy who's like just a very talented, like career musician and teacher. And he does a thing where
father, lover, brother,
Wait, what?
But he he'll like listen to songs that the audience suggests and then like break them down musically, what's going on, kind of in a like, I stumbled across them recommended because of like guitar tutorial, like Marty music and shit like that. So I thought that's what it was going to be. Uh-huh. But he like watches a performance and then like will hold up his hand for like what chord is that. Like, it's crazy how quickly he picks things up.
Dude, and that's crazy.
If he finds a really cool part, he's like, let me pause that, go back a little bit.
On the video.
All right, so here's what's going on here, stuff like that. And he did one of the ones that someone suggested was The Silence from this album. And I never really checked out The Silence, mm-hmm. but watching him watch that, I was like, damn, this song is really impactful. And then they close out every show with The Silence. So when we saw them live, I was like emotionally touched and moved by that song. Like, I almost started crying listening to it live. So since then, I've wanted to do this, but it was like right after that we started all the guest episodes, and then I just hadn't done it before now. And I was like, you know what? It's time before it starts to get spring and summer, and I don't want to listen to this kind of music anymore. So I snuck it in,
dude. Yeah, because right now it's going back and forth between, it's going to be like 80, I don't know if you saw, Nick, it's going to be like 80 degrees this week or something.
I know, it's ridiculous.
And it was 33 degrees this morning. And I'm like, oh no, it's the North Carolina weather season where it's like, so like going back and forth between.
Cue every other tweet being North Carolina weather schizophrenic.
Or like the, okay, so this is like second winter. Like, first winter was like already, and then like we're about to have like pre-summer, but like third winter is after that, and then we get actual spring, and then we get actual.
But you gotta summer. Wait. Gotta wait for April for the last freeze, though. You gotta wait for the April.
The last freeze. Yep. You gotta wait, for-
mm-hmm. bro.
The climate fuck? Change I have, not real for sure.
Dude, yep. I have memories of being a child and helping my dad wrap chicken wire around all of our like big. Like the fig trees and shit in the yard before the April freeze, like waking up at like 4 a.m. and wrapping all of our like trees.
Come on, son! Like- we gotta get the chicken wire.
It's like that's the closest to like living on a like my parents have a farmhouse and there is a hay barn.
Yeah,
but the hay barn's for just like storage of like old bed frames and shit. And then my dad has a lot of like really cool gardens. So he grows a lot of produce, but it's not it's like a farm. It's just like he eats it and he grows like vegetables and fruits.
Yeah.
What a guy. Like, dude, I want a fucking yard. Beautiful. I want to be
the yard.
Like, not commercially, but just personally agrarian, you know?
Yeah.
Your dad opened my eyes to the taste of fresh
vegetables.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, wait, to what?
No, seriously.
Fresh
it's
arugula.
Crazy. Yeah, just like walking out, picking up a leaf, and then biting it. It's a whole different experience.
I've never gotten fresh arugula before.
You're like, yo, this tastes like fucking cracked black pepper. Wait, you guys live 2 hours from my dad? Yeah. No, it's crazy.
Bro, if I pull up in your house without you, and I'm like, yo, Jamie's dad, give me some black pepper arugula, bro.
You could hit up my dad. He'd be like, hell yeah.
Just don't want to say anything. Just like one Saturday, just pull up and like walk into the backyard and like... go into the garden and Jamie's mom comes out like to the deck and is like, hey, wait.
Dude, she'd Jordan? Be so freaked
what?
Out. She'd be so
what are you doing?
Out, dude. That'd you're, be so awesome.
And you're like, hey, I just wanted to try some arugula.
Yeah.
Nicky and Jamie were talking about some fucking arugula.
I just like,
I don't know. Yeah, I mean.
I just like lean it over like by like the root and just like cut that like whole like arugula plant off and just like, thanks. I just like, I like chop it at like the base of it. Just,
yeah,
thanks, man.
I guess Nick has a new car, but I was gonna say it'd be even funnier because you would just roll up and like they know who you are, but it's not like if Zach or Nick or Sam, like it's not if someone who like
no, I know that's
all
like
the time growing up whenever
that's why it'd be funnier.
My dad might like go up for the gun locker and then be like, wait a minute,
the gun.
That's that podcast guy. What the hell?
The fuck?
Hey, that's that gay boy that Jamie hangs out with. He got that long hair and painted nails. He's a little sissy boy.
We're making your dad sound like he's like some.
Yeah,
country,
I know. Sorry, it's literally just because you guys live in an area.
Yeah, literally, we live in an area where that's what the neighbors would be like. But my family.
Oh
like
my gosh, your sister's
gay.
Literally gay. I promise you, Jamie's dad is not like that. It's just funny. It's just funny coming like funny as someone who lives near that. It's just so I don't know what like. Yeah. I know it's not that funny because the joke is like beaten into the ground, but like for some reason, it's still just so funny because you know, like sometimes jokes are funny just because of how like true it is. And so if I go up to like somebody who actually lives in like Yakin County, I'm like, you're a country bumpkin.
Oh, yeah.
And they're like, no, I ain't a country bumpkin. And you're like, dude, this is even funnier because you're denying it now. And now I have to make more fun of you, you know?
Yeah. No, dude, there are definitely places where if I'm like, fuck, I'm going the wrong way down this road, I'm not pulling in someone's driveway to turn around. I'm going to the end of the road.
Oh, wow. I didn't even know that.
That's the entirety of YO Road. I'm not turning around in someone's driveway. I am
really?
Just going through
They would
the
come
orchard.
Out that quickly?
I don't know, but okay, yeah, potentially.
Yeah. Okay.
Man,
okay.
Like, if it's like nighttime and like they see your headlights turn in.
Yeah.
No, God. Absolutely not.
That's bad.
Nope.
Yeah. Jesus.
No, not doing that shit. But yeah, no, dude, you both could literally just text my parents and be like, "Hey, is it cool? Like a new produce
garden tour?"
Yeah.
Oh, is arugula
in season? Out seasonally?
That is
spring,
crazy.
Summer. I think it's a spring summer one, dude.
Oh wait, no, that's not that crazy. Actually, seasonally makes sense.
He went in PowerPoint. He started doing this. He goes in PowerPoint and he like uses rectangles to like plan out where he's gonna do it and shit.
That's pretty cool.
Like, bro, Illustrator, he'd be fucking going crazy. But instead, he's doing his drawings in PowerPoint.
PowerPoint is the superior
design software.
Yeah, image creation software.
Not even publisher. Just PowerPoint.
And graphic design is my passion on PowerPoint.
Right click, ungroup. It crashes your computer.
God damn.
Bro, I don't even remember how.
Only for the real PowerPoint heads.
Talk about arugula. Talk about, I don't know. How did we start talking about that?
I know where it diverged, but I don't remember what the topic was before that point.
I don't remember how to diverge.
We started talking about my dad's garden and the arugula.
Oh, that sorry, I thought you meant like the. Okay. I get what you're saying now.
Damn, I fully lost that one.
Yeah, Divergent. Yeah, I love that movie.
Yeah. Oh yeah, Shailene Woodley and
that dude from White Lotus.
The other guy.
I actually have never seen Divergent.
The dude from White Lotus season 2, he's in it, isn't he?
I don't know.
I've actually never seen Divergent.
Which dude?
the like rich guy who's the dickhead.
The
Cam?
Ripped one or the Cam? Yeah.
Yeah.
Maybe. I think I might have seen Divergent once. Because my sister was like went ape shit for the books.
Oh, yeah. Uh-huh.
But I think that's him.
Yeah, what do you see is his actual name? Like
Theo James, that's him.
Yeah, uh-huh. Yeah, that's him.
He's English.
English?
You find out
in
American accent.
My beans and toast.
Beans and toast, you call me.
I'm taking the tube to work.
All right, mate. It's time for my first dental checkup in 30 years. Hopefully it goes well. Hopefully I've been doing everything right. I don't know, though.
This is ungodly spicy. How much black pepper did you put on this?
Sorry.
I'm here for it.
Oh, God. That was so good. That was a good joke. That was a really good joke.
That was a good bit.
I was definitely doing like not an English accent, like an Australian accent.
Dude, it sounded English enough, dude. I'm not gonna lie.
Thank you,
dude. I heard the craziest accent ever. So we've been watching.
Imitate it.
Not doing that. But we've been watching Worth It on YouTube a lot. Just going back in because it's fun to watch. But there was someone, they were down in Australia and they were like first generation, I think Chinese.
Okay.
So like their parents are Chinese, and so they grew up like hearing Chinese. But like the like Chinese Australian accent was crazy. It was unlike anything I've ever heard before. It was fascinating. I was like, damn. It was so weird, but it was cool. It was a cool accent. That was just the most unique accent I've heard in like ever, I think, in my life. I was like, damn, that's awesome.
Yeah,
dude, that's crazy. We've been
the human brain is fascinating.
No, I'm not gonna say that. I'll tell you guys after. I'm like, should I say that? No, I should definitely tell you after.
Oh,
sorry. It's something I was like, maybe, and I was like, nah, probably. It's
controversial,
not like
take.
It's no. It's really not controversial at all. It's just like, it's just kind of funny.
It's
but
just
like
racist.
Maybe
it's not controversial. It's just bad. No. Yeah. Yeah, everyone thinks it's bad.
There's no controversy. Everyone agrees. It's just racist.
It's not even It's not even something like you could like have an opinion on. Really, it's just something that. Never mind. I'm gonna keep talking about it. We're gonna get to it, and I'll tell you after.
All right.
But man, but bless their orchestra.
I was gonna say, Jordan, what did you think of the album?
Big vibes, very cool. Mobbing out.
No, I actually did like it a lot. I actually did like it.
Really? Okay.
Yeah. Surprisingly, like,
dude, that shit is so funny.
There were some. More hype moments. I guess hyper is not the word because hyper means like you know.
Dude, what if I told you there's a Nightcore remix of this?
Bro, you stop hating on Nightcore, bro. You stop hating on Nightcore, bro. But I'm saying, like, I don't know.
Amazing.
I like... amazing. It's... I just like the music a lot. Again, as far as lyrics go, it was here and there. Again, I think we all agree that, like, it's hard to super dissect the depth of lyrics sometimes. In some albums,
yeah,
because
sure.
Of just, you know, music is very much listening. And actually, I guess you could go more in depth with music, but it's easier for us to dissect words because we know a lot about words and it is like music theory, you know, or like how hard that is. Yeah. Like, you know, you're like, yeah, I mean, kind of you, Jamie, even said you like look people up on YouTube that do it or like the guy like pause it or whatever and like talks about it a little bit or he like whatever. I don't know if Nick's super into that or not. I'm not sure. I don't think so, but...
What, like music theory?
Yeah.
Oh, no.
Huh. I was about to say, but like... For you, this is kind of like, you know, a 40 thing where you're like, oh, you can listen to the lyrics, but you can also listen to like the music and like how, you know, hard a chord was or something. I don't really know. But as far as the music goes, I don't know why. I also thought that it would like not resonate with me because of the other album too, but... For some reason, this was a lot more my speed, I think.
Oh, yeah?
Like, songs like The Grocery, I liked really a lot. And maybe it's just, like, maybe his voice was more enunciated, and that's why I liked it. I think his voice just fit with the music a lot more, which is maybe why I think I liked it more than other albums. A lot of times, again, I told you I don't like the, like, falsetto, but this guy was, like, actually, I don't know. There's just some like, again, yeah. I have some certain nostalgia for like, you know, it's nothing like Daughtry, but like Daughtry, I could like hear what he was saying and also like the music, you know, kind of like that. Or like, like even like LSD when we listen to that, like I can hear the music and also hear what they're saying. And sometimes voices just go well together. And I think this album and his voice just go really well together.
That's true. And that's one thing I always love about, I've always loved about all their music is I really like Andy's voice. Andy Hull is the lead singer and songwriter.
Okay.
And live, this is what he sounds like.
Okay.
Nice.
Like his voice is crystal clear, yet also like adds distortion when he wants it to, like when he's yelling in songs, but it still is like just rising above everything else, like clears a bell. Very, it's impressive how close this sounds, specifically this album, to what he sounds like live. It blew my mind when he first started singing at the concert. I was like, holy shit, this is
did
like.
Did you see him at Red Rocks or?
No, we saw him at the Mission Ballroom out here.
I don't know if like live sound like mic technology has just gotten a lot better, or if like the style of music is definitely different than the style of music I listen to now is definitely different than what I listened to when I was younger. But I feel like watching like live performances on TV or like hearing people live that I didn't necessarily seek out, but like that my parents liked, or like just music that I didn't really find, but music that was around me growing up. I feel like it sounded so much more different live than the music I listen to like now. And I don't know if that's because of like independent artists just like not caring as much and not editing their voices as much, or if technology has just gotten better like across the board.
Right.
But I remember distinctly like being younger and like watching CMT with my parents and like seeing the Country Music Awards and like hearing Brad Paisley sing live, and I was like, he sounds bad. Like, yeah. I was like, he sounds like way worse than he does on his album. and they thought it was really funny, and they were like, well, it's just because it's live and it's not like on the CD. And I was like, they can't make him sound any better. Like, he sounds like trash.
How does this guy get a career, Brett?
That was my little kid opinion. And now, that's like,
a little mud on the tires.
and now I go back, and he's like one of the few like 2000s people that I can listen to like three songs by and not want to like cut one of my toes off. But I'm Gonna Miss Her. Amazing song.
I'm gonna miss her. Dude, that song is incredible.
I'd rather go fishing.
I love showing it to people who didn't grow up listening to country music as well. Uh-huh. And they're like, what the fuck? I'm like, wait for it. Wait, this is the funniest song of all time.
But
I need to listen to that song. I've never heard it.
It's great. I got reminded of it because one of my cousins sent me a link to Post Malone covering it, and it's like
he covers
Sturgill Simpson song.
Wasn't that the first time that people were like, Post Malone does country music too? Isn't that when that video blew up?
He started covering country music like in Texas. That's how he started making music.
Crazy. Yeah. He like switched to I'll be popping hold that fucking baby, but I'll be like a rock star. Yeah,
and then his first album was Stony, and you're like, holy shit,
dude, I'm not joking.
That's crazy.
Sorry, little tangent, but like it's good music. I don't have a problem with it. But you'll see that like a lot of like it's usually like white artists adopt some sort of like hip hop / R&B sound to become popular and then revert back to a different sound once they get popular. Like Justin Bieber did it. Like he was like more hip hop, you know, like having collabs with like Ludacris and stuff. And now he makes like more, you know, like DJ Snake at, you know, stuff like that. Or I Feel Funny.
Yeah.
Machine Gun Kelly did it. I don't think you guys have ever listened to Machine Gun Kelly like before he like.
To Machine Gun Kelly has been against my will.
Okay. Machine Gun Kelly made like rap music, like with Waka Flocka. Like Wild Boy was the first song I listened to like a couple years ago with him in it. And like, I knew Machine Gun Kelly as like a rap artist first, which like, but everybody views him as like, you know, this like pop punk, you know, but like, that's just,
I didn't know he started playing like pop punk instead until recently. I thought he still did like the rap rock thing. Like thought that's what he did. Yeah.
What dude, you've seen him like painting his nails and like doing like the eyeliner thing. And that's like, that's not really, but his newest album I think is like that. Well, he's only guitar on
Megan
it.
Megan Fox, bro.
Wait, did he cheat on Megan Fox?
Yeah, that's why they're like split up or whatever.
Oh shit, I didn't know that. But it just happens a lot, guys. More and Post Malone is guilty of it. As good as his music is, you know, he's just a little bit guilty of it. You know,
we're rediscovering cultural appropriation live on the podcast.
No, it's actually something I've just seen on like it happens.
You guys have heard about this thing. But
it's like they do it to get like cool points, and then once they're famous, they just like don't care about it anymore, you know? Like, okay, I'm cool now. I can go back to my actually doing things that I want to do.
Yeah.
So, yeah, sorry. That's just my little mini rant. And you guys may disagree or agree, probably disagree, but, you know, it's just something I feel slightly passionate about.
I don't think anyone can disagree with that. That just seems like objectively true.
Yeah.
Macklemore talks about it in some of his songs.
Oh, yeah, Macklemore. Yeah.
Well, I guess you can't even really say like he's he's doing it for the money, I guess, because that's like the only style of music he's ever made.
That is true. Macklemore is that is true.
Like I guess you could.
He just liked hip hop growing up in Seattle.
Yeah,
that is true.
Rapper.
And Macklemore, he's trying to actually rap about real issues. He's not just like I don't know, just like generically making rap music to try and make money. Like,
and then he sends a text to Kendrick Lamar and says, "Bro, you should have so won that, bro. I'm so sorry. It was rigged.
My bad, bro.
Bro, I would literally give you this. I will give you this trophy if you want it, bro. You literally deserve it more than I do. I'm so sorry.
God, that's you so, can pay so. The money for it, and I'll send it to you. It's all good.
Yeah. That's one of the funniest things that I didn't know until like last year.
You have to pay like $200 or $300 for an award, like the Grammys or the Oscars and shit.
Yeah, like if you get a Grammy or an Oscar, you have to pay for it. Like,
wait, really? Just like, how much is it? $200 or $300?
Yeah, I think it's. I don't think it's like a couple grand or anything. I think it's just okay. It's like a couple hundred, but it's still like
which
you're
is
giving
almost
me this.
More in-
you're
it's
you're giving
more insulting to me.
Yeah, like that, you guys can't only- cover the couple hundred for all these things that you're giving us.
Yeah. Like that
is kind of weird.
That's like asking your friend, you're like, "Hey man, can I get that dollar you owe me?" Yeah, thanks. Like,
bro.
Most of those people who win are like either many hundreds of thousands or like millionaires. And it's like, why are they saying like, "Hey, pay $300 and we'll give you this little statue."
And then, hey, bro, and then I know you're hosting this party, but do you mind buying?
I'm sure it's like
the alcohol while I'm here.
I'm sure it's the same for all the winners. So like what, like the short film makers who like definitely lost money making this like Oscar winning short film. They're like, congratulations, but also for like the three directors, we're gonna need about $1,000. Like overall, like,
bro, just
whenever
dude.
You're ready.
It's so fucked up.
Or like the folk musicians who like definitely also lost money, like making their album. They're just trying to make ends meet, like touring around the country, and they're like, "Oh yeah, from you, just 300. Come on,
that'll be bro. Just cough it up, bro. Come on, you literally made a good movie. You literally made a good movie, bro. Come on, give me.
We know that. Everyone knows that translates to money, you know, like it's like passion project. Like, yeah, but that equals money. You know, you get money.
Yeah, exactly.
Good enough. Now,
right. Yeah, that's just so funny and like fucked up.
Yeah.
But this album is not very funny, but it's very good and kind of fucked up.
Tell us about it, Jim. Yeah.
Speaking
really
of fucked up. Fucked up in a good way.
Oh, okay.
Yep.
Are you going to elaborate on that?
Jamie's buffering?
No, I'm not.
Jamie's lagging IRL, dude. Oh, my God.
All right, hit
Jamie
the lag
Dupe?
Switch.
Jamie Dupe?
Host advantage. Host advantage.
Host advantage.
No, I was, sorry, I was just leaving you out to dry there. I was going to let you cook and then realized you were done cooking.
But let
no,
him
no, I was,
cook!
I realized I didn't have the lyrics pulled up like I wanted to.
Oh, okay.
But yeah, like Amaze starts off really good. I think it's a good intro, and it's interesting that it starts off him talking about. So this album came out. I'm pretty sure it was right around when his daughter was born.
Okay.
He constantly says like, you know. She like having the birth of my daughter really like grounded me to like reality and like was a big pivotal life moment. And
your wife standing so there like, "Oh, I guess I'm chopped liver." Huh? Not good.
I'm nothing to you. Until you get to the parts and you realize. But yeah, so it's very interesting that it's like he starts off the album talking about his daughter and then ends it talking about his daughter after going through like the massive narrative loop of the album.
Oh yeah.
Just thought it was a cool like cyclical thing where, you know, you start off talking about like, oh, like you lift the burden off of me. And that's how the album starts. Like that's how that song ends. It's him just saying that over and over.
It's only beginning, swallowing us. Somebody said it's unspeakable love to me.
And then it goes into like just very heavy, like we talked about earlier, themes of like, what is our purpose and God and just like human suffering and tragedy. Mm-hmm. And then ends again with essentially him praying over his daughter in the last song on the album. So it's really cool. But I really like it as an intro. It kind of sets it up where it's like, okay, this album, this is the style of album we're getting into.
Yeah.
And yeah.
I think it was a little too melancholic for me for an opening song, you know, but that's, the album is melancholic to a sense, you know?
Yeah.
But if someone just listening to the music mostly, like obviously I did listen to some lyrics, but like listening to the music mostly, it like ebbed and flowed a little bit. I'm trying to think, like, I just didn't really like the first song, and maybe that's just like a standalone, you know, I'm just like looking at the song as like a standalone and not like a piece of like a bigger puzzle, you know? And maybe it's just like the first time, maybe it's like the first song. And so that was like my very, very first impression, like of the whole thing without listening to any of it any number of times, yeah. You know? But it might grow on me, but as far as like an intro, I didn't love it that much.
I got you.
I did like it. I didn't know that it was about his daughter at first, but also I didn't look into the lyrics super deep on this first song. I really mainly just looked into them on some of the ones that just caught my attention, like purely from listening to them, like just like stuff catching my ear, like when I'm just doing like other things,
yeah.
like especially songs like The Grocery and The Alien and The Gold, but I did like this first song, and I noticed kind of the play on words that he makes where he says like, I'm amazed to you, and then he also says it's amazing, and apparently also
so amazing.
apparently, like, I think his daughter's name is Maisie, Mayzie. So it's almost like a triple entendre, which is
I never thought about that. But
you should have talked about corn also.
apparently, like. Well, I don't know why I said apparently. It seems like he spends a lot of time thematically relating his lyrics and also just making them way deeper than they are on the surface. And I admittedly should have spent more time looking into the lyrics than I really did for this album, because it seems like they probably would have hit home very, very hard if I would have spent more time looking into them. As I'm reading them right now, going, "Oh shit! Like this is kind of yeah. this is kind of wild."
Yeah.
but I did like the first song. I did like Amaze. The Maze. Yeah.
And it's cool because I never. It wasn't until like this morning, because I like basically listened to this album a lot, and then this morning, I like sat down and was just like in bed listening to this, reading the lyrics along with it. And I didn't know like what even like a black mile on the surface was. I knew that it was said in The Gold, but beyond that, I didn't really understand what it was. Right. So yeah, this is one where it greatly benefits from looking into the lyrics, because I mean, Andy Hull is just an insanely talented songwriter and storyteller as well.
I feel like, yes, storyteller and songwriter, two things that I feel like just aren't executed super well by a lot of musicians in like modern music. You hear a lot of like great old concept albums from like classic rock, like I guess like the Beatles kind of invented concept albums, but they weren't really storytelling. It was just more like,
yeah,
like generic themes and stuff, and I couldn't completely say, like this one is a bit thematic with stories thrown in, or is it a like complete story all the way through?
It's a lot of, yeah, I don't know if it's quite a complete story, but it's definitely like
it's
recurring
like
characters and narrators throughout, having,
yeah, it's like
just going through experiences of them,
yeah, like interconnecting people's lives within like a region or a town.
In a small mining town in South Dakota.
Yeah. And I that's
Which
something
is weird,
that I,
because he's from Georgia.
Yeah. that's something that I thought of too. I was like, wait, isn't he from Georgia? Like,
yeah.
I think, Does he mention like Rome, Georgia?
He mentions in the Rome album? And Lawrenceville,
Georgia. Gotcha. Lawrenceville.
In I think it's in no. It's in one of the songs, like he talked about writing the suicide note and going down to Georgia.
Yeah, it's in The Alien.
Maybe it's in, is it an Alien? What? Uh-huh. Yeah, yeah.
Damn.
Yeah, so he mentions Georgia, but beyond that, this is mostly centered around, it's using like the narrative of a few characters in Lead, South Dakota, which was a gold mine town, to like talk about human suffering, basically. It's crazy. It's so weird. There's so many layers to it. I don't know the inspiration was.
But. Yeah, it's really reminiscent of like the only reason I'm thinking of this is because Andy Schaaf released an album last week, and like I feel like neither of you guys would really like it very much. Like, but
no, but I love it probably.
the writing style is similar to this album, where it like interconnects people's stories, like living just in a similar area, and that's like that's something that I continually like have figured out that I just enjoy a lot in
living in a different area. Sorry,
no.
In
writing music or like TV shows or movies, like okay. like like
dude, that's people's yeah.
It's like a thematic correlation between little stories in different people's lives.
Like
it's really present in this album. It's really present in Andy Schaaf's new album Norm, and like also in like a movie that I really love. I wouldn't necessarily say it's like one of my favorites of all time or anything, but it's the movie Magnolia that like Paul Thomas Anderson made. That
I
has
have,
like
oh yeah yeah we talked about
it that. it has like amazing performances by like Tom Cruise is in it and like Tom Cruise, Philip Seymour Hoffman's in it, Julianne Moore, John C. Reilly in like a dramatic role that you don't see him in a lot.
Who's that again? Okay.
Sidney Baker Hall. John C. Reilly is like the comedic guy who plays like alongside Will Ferrell in a lot of those big movies.
Oh,
like
yeah.
He's the other guy in Step Brothers.
He was the other Step Brother.
It was El Diablo.
Yeah. yeah, that was him.
He was Dewey
Magic
Cox.
Man. Yeah, he was Dewey Cox. Yeah.
You don't want none of this, Dewey. Hey, don't do that.
Movie is oh,
Hangover? Johnny Cash knockoff.
He was in The Hangover.
So no. Oh. That's a line from like Dewey Cox, the Wall Card story. It's like a.
I've never seen that movie.
I've seen scenes it's from good. It and like part of it. Like when I was younger,
it's
but I need to sit down and watch the whole thing. But there's a scene where like this guy's introducing him like this Johnny Cash parody character to marijuana, and he's like nah, sorry, like I don't want any of that, like it's gonna give me a hangover, and he's like it doesn't give you hangovers, like there's nothing bad about it, and he's like, well, I don't want to get addicted, and he's like it's actually not very addictive at all.
Like, it's non-habit forming.
Yeah. and they go back and forth like four or five times about how it's like actually like not a bad thing at all. He's like really okay, funny. Well, maybe I will try it.
Yeah. No, and then they do it with like as the decades progress in the movie, they do it with different drugs. That was like
the 60s or 70s.
And then they do it with like coke in the 80s, and then like heroin in the 90s.
Like, this is actually the worst drug you could probably do. But yeah. We're going to give it to poor people and arrest them for it, but we can do it all the time.
Reaganomics.
It's so funny that like I feel like in history books, like he's just painted as like, yeah, this actor guy got to be president. everything was good for like the whole time he was here, and then
I know.
The older we get, we're like, oh wait, like
he fucked everything up in this country.
It seemed like for everyone who wasn't white, everything got really bad for a while.
even people. Okay. Obviously not as bad.
Who were white? Like everyone has suffered since Ronald.
Yeah, sorry. Just to be very clear, there's obviously a disproportionate amount of bad stuff that happened to people of color, you know? But overall, just bad, you know? Just not good.
Credit cards used to not affect like car loans or renting things and shit like that until there was like a Reagan era policy repealed that and made like credit scores affect that as well.
That's
or something
crazy.
Like that.
Didn't know that.
That or like it used to, like paying those used to like. No, I think they were tax write offs. Interest on auto loans and credit cards you could write off on taxes.
Yeah, that's what that's the TikToker tweet that I saw too.
Yeah, it's every like 2 to 3 weeks something else comes up. Someone's like, hey, by the way, this was ruined by Reagan too, and it's like, oh, he really is burning in hell. If it
did you see the tweet that was like
looking for Ronald Reagan?
If you just like blindly said like, oh, this is probably because of Reagan, you'd be like more right than wrong, probably.
Yeah,
like oh, this thing is
pretty much every like societal problems like trending, and it like skyrockets in the 80s where every other country doesn't really skyrocket. It's yeah. What's the spike? Oh, it's the 1980s.
Oh, it's Reagan. Trickle down economics, guys. It works. Guys, just pay the rich people
promise.
More.
Guys, we're about 40 years in. It's gonna start working soon. I promise.
Guys, right? Trust me. They're gonna start being more nice. They're gonna start being nice and get willingly giving up their money because that's what capitalists do. I promise you guys. I promise you guys. Trust me, guys. It's not that innovation
guys,
has improved
to
where you
to
don't even need workers
the railroad
anymore.
Industry. Yeah.
Not like we need to like just you know only have robots doing work and so then nobody actually gets any money so ugh.
Man
oh, well. That was this a hard
is,
stop
this is like the articulation of my inner monologue most days
yeah
whenever I start like reading off news headlines or like giving my like my doomer like talk whenever I start going doomer mode with my girlfriend and she's like you gotta stop this is like just bumming me out right and I'm like,
shut the fuck up and watch our TV show.
I can't really help it. I'm sorry. It's just
I sit there and then I go fuck it, we ball.
Somehow the world keeps spinning and I don't quite understand it, but you know we'll
yeah
it we'll happens. Try and make the best of it. So anyways, back to this album.
Really uplifting with the song all about heartbreak and maybe dying in a coal mine collapse. Yeah, The Gold is really good. It was definitely the lead single, and there's a cover with Phoebe Bridgers for the song, and it's very good.
Yeah, I feel like that kind of, like, I feel like that gave them a little, hopefully it gave them a little exposure to a new audience that they didn't really have a lot of exposure to beforehand.
I would imagine so. And I also feel like they probably like, especially if someone found that song and then they were like, oh, like Phoebe fans who listen to that, if they were then like, I want to see what the other song that this is. And then they looked at this album, hopefully that also maybe like kind of got them the door a little bit more as well.
Yeah,
because I feel like especially this album by them is like Phoebe fans could probably rock with it.
Yeah, at least lyrically.
Yeah,
that's thanks.
My ceiling.
Yeah,
I don't
just
think
the
I love
my ceiling
anymore. That gold
mitochondria.
But yeah, it's really good.
Yeah, just like. The guitar melody and like just jumping right into it like from the very start, just like rushing into the like rhythm of it all. And I mean just the chorus being I believed you were crazy and you believe you love me, like the even just the phrasing of that one statement, you believed you love me, there's a lot like to unpack in just those couple words. Like you believed you love me means like you convinced yourself that you love me even though like you probably really didn't, or like you loved some like ideal version of me even though like that's not really who I was, like, but he says that in much fewer words, and that's just powerful songwriting. It's just great songwriting. Yeah. Like, and the fact that they like basically just cut the instruments whenever he like sings that out into the void. Oh my god, it's just
chills.
Ooh.
It's so good.
It's hard.
Actually, fire.
Yeah, like that's just okay, just
bars.
The chorus. I believed you were crazy. You believed that you love me.
Yeah. 40 miles out of east, Illinois, from my old man's heart attack. And it's about two people who were like in a relationship, or at least like were at one time, like they cared for each other, but now it's I believe you're crazy, you believed you love me. Like it's quite yeah. sad.
You and me, we're a day drink, so lose your faith in me. And then that's like they just repeat it in the song. It's so fucking good. But like, and it's even still, with all of that going on, he's using like the gold mine and like a minor. I think it's sung from like the wife's perspective, but it talks about like a collapsing gold mine and like other bad shit happening in life. But the father's advice, you don't open your eyes for a while. You just breathe that moment down. Like you just like hold your eyes closed and just like grit through it. 40 miles out of East Illinois for my old man's heart attack. Like, his life is falling apart, and then it's setting up the location outside of East Illinois. Mm-hmm. And then it's like, while all of this other bad shit's happening, my like father, who I've had a rocky relationship with, is like dying as well. Mm-hmm. So like two songs in, already setting up like crazy, sad shit. Yeah, I don't know. I love it. And then I really like the second verse. I don't want to bark here anymore. Black Hills, the collie. I don't really know why he says bark here. Maybe like yelling and fighting. I don't know. But Black Hills, the collie. The collie is, I didn't know it, but it's actually like soot and grime, like where coal dust accumulates.
Ooh.
And so talking about Black Hills, because it's in like the Black Hills of South Dakota is where the album takes place. Was it really dangerous for us? We'd just catch you coughing. Like, we're just having to do what we're going to do. Yeah, what the hell are we going to do a black mile to the surface? And it's like, that is like leaving the coal mine after a collapse. Like the only way to get out is just to go back, which once there's a collapse, like you can't see anything. So like, it's either that or die. And then also like having to get out of the despair of like a falling apart relationship and like all this other shit. And it's all just like, that's the title of the album as well. Where it's just like, what the fuck? Really good writing though. Really, really good writing.
Yeah.
I don't want to be here anymore. It all tastes like poison. Damn.
What tastes like poison?
What?
Just like the air, after, like you're dying in like a pit.
That's awful.
Yeah, it's
I did not get that from the song. I'm sorry. I did not.
No, exactly. That's the thing. But like, if you don't get it, you're just like, okay, yeah, I don't really know, you know, what's going on.
Yeah.
Like all of that shit is in there.
And this is probably one of the most rhythmically, like, one of the most up-tempo songs on the album that,
yeah,
like you could say that a lot of them, especially, yeah, including this one, are high energy, but this one is one of the most, like, it's one of the higher BPM ones, so if you're not really paying attention to the lyrics, like, especially in the verses where it is more, like, up-tempo, like, versus the chorus where it kind of cuts and he's like singing despairingly, but like if you're not really paying attention to the lyrics a whole lot, you're probably just like, oh yeah, this is a good rock song. Like, I didn't know they made pretty good rock music like this anymore. And then you really listen to it and you're like, oh, like, yeah, I don't want to be here anymore. It all tastes like poison. Like,
yeah,
damn,
yeah,
bro.
Like, hey, what the fuck's going on? Yeah.
And it's like, it's literally, it could be about like the coal mine, or it also could be figuratively like talking about the relationship. Like,
yeah, like the relationship. And
yeah. The air in this house feels poisonous because I don't want to be here anymore.
Crazy. And it's all just like, just written. Like, he just wrote that. Mm-hmm. Like, that apparently it was the last song written for the album. I guess it like kind of ties everything thematically together. But that's what's crazy is some of these songs are like, they were written like 2 years before the album was even like conceptualized. It's just like stuff he had that he wanted to get out. And then I was like, yeah, it fits in. And then it all fits together so well.
That's really impressive that him. And I've heard, it's weird how like another like a writer that I've heard talk about that is Andy Schaaf, where he talks about people see the polished finished product, like they see the thematic relationships of like all these songs intertwining because so much work went into it. Like, they don't see like the 50 other songs that you wrote that like just didn't really quite thematically intertwine, and so you were like, oh, can't really use that one, or like they don't see the 100 unfinished songs that just didn't really make the cut because you like had this initial spark and then you're like, oh, this didn't really pan out. Crumple up, throw it in the trash can, new one. And like, that's why it takes 4 years to come out with a new album like this. Like, if you're living your life and you're having kids and you're like building a family, like you only have like so much time to devote to songwriting. And then, when you do start songwriting, when you do start songwriting, like, not everyone is good. So that's why it takes so long to produce like a final polished, like, great product.
Makes sense.
And then especially with like, cause the songwriting is only part of it, because then like, especially with this kind of music, there's so much going on. You have to get all of the layers just right for like your vision as well. So it takes so long.
Yeah.
And it turns out fucking great. But I fully understand when people are like, why have this person just put on music in so long? I'm like, well, listen to what they make. Yeah. It takes a lot of time to do that.
It only takes hours and months and years of painstaking work to create a polished, complete product. Like,
why can't they do it in 6 months, dude?
Yeah.
Dude.
And I think I've heard Jason Isbell talk about it before, about how like people in the 70s could take breaks from songwriting and making music because they made enough money from like record sales and touring. Like, they didn't have to keep churning out material to just make a living. But now if you're a musician, it's like, oh, like, it took you 4 years to make another album. Like maybe you can put food on the table if you're lucky.
That sounds already come and gone. Sorry, we're already in a new hyper pop country now.
Yeah, like if you're on like a certain kind of label and like you make a similar style of music for too long, they're probably like glad this was the like end of your contract. Like, why would we sign you again? This isn't the kind of music anyone likes to listen to now.
Literally, brev.
Yeah. It's fucked, man.
God damn.
Yeah, it's got to be crazy. But The Moth is a song that... My last thing for The Gold was like the last chorus where it's just his voice in the piano is like haunting. I love that shit. It's tracked so well. Really gets you. The Moth is interesting because I learned the word metonymy.
Metonymy?
Enlighten me.
The chorus is forced myself to take a different name, buried with metonymy. It's the substitution of the name of an attribute or adjunct for the same thing. For example, suit for business executive, or the track for a horse racing. MF just threw it in there.
It's describing kind of something of its parts, kind of. Yeah.
Yeah, I think so. Even the definition's like
confusing. Isn't this kind of like what a synecdoche is?
Dude, that's what I was going to say. I was literally thinking that. Dude, I'm not even joking. I was thinking that, Nick. I was like, a synecdoche. I remember because it was like, it's describing something connected. And that's how I like remembered on like my vocab quiz. It's like something that connected to the person, but not actually about that person. Dude, Nick, we are... Bro, give me some gap. Like that word is like in like foreign enough that I didn't say it because I was like, eh, I'll just think this to myself. But you said it and I was like,
well, yes, yeah, Nicholas. I feel like that's a word that just randomly comes up like once a year for me, and every time it comes up, I'm like, what does this mean? Like,
yeah,
I know I used to know.
It's a type of metonymy.
Ah, let's go. Me and Nick God. On the
it's a rectangle square situation, I believe.
Dude, I'm so glad. I honestly have some vocab words like beat into my head because I had to like do it so much in high school.
I have no idea what synecdoche means.
Well, you just looked it up, so now you...
Yeah, I'm going to forget. Don't worry.
Oh, okay.
Don't worry. It's not locked in for long, all right?
Ask me again in like an hour and I will not know.
God, I'm sorry. That's like a little like win that I'm just like, wow, me like that's just... Sorry, that's... Anyways.
The public school system actually didn't fail me for once. That's good.
Small victories in the
who would
public
have known
school.
That English class would eventually be worth it rather than just forcing me to read.
Yeah, it's not like shit. This is actually somewhere where it's needed and not just, you know, a casual conversation between friends that makes me feel like the school system did something.
What are you talking about? This is a professional endeavor, all right?
Doomer mode. Doomer mode. It's fun knowing stuff, all right? Let's go.
Exactly.
Let's go.
Exactly. It's fun knowing shit.
We're media entrepreneurs, all right?
Yeah, this one, this was one of the singles for it. I think it's about like bearing the hatchet with like his dad who's like dying or some shit. I don't know. I forced myself to take a different name, buried with metonymy, like using a different thing to mean myself. I don't know. Names are weird when you think about it. Decide for me, throw the man you used to be away, bury him with rivalry entirely. I don't really know what it is, but it's good. I think it's about religion, like wrestling with religion.
Interesting.
Yeah, but the outro in it is actually his daughter saying, "What about my future?"
In the moth?
Oh man.
Used on it. Yeah. Yeah, it's like wrestling with religion and his dad, because he talks about like my entire life, you've been obsessing with the light. Closer you get, the further you get. You want to hear it. You want to feel it when he dies. If you walk that path alone, you've got to look him in the eye. I don't know. It's like, yeah, I guess it's like a strained relationship with a dying dad or something like that. I'm not quite sure. But maybe. I always enjoy listening to it.
I wonder if, I don't know for sure, because like I said earlier, I should have read the lyrics more than I really did, but maybe like, that's the brother of the character in The Alien, because I know like the character in The Alien has a very strained relationship with her dad, but and it sounds like he also has a strained relationship with his dad in the moth, but you know, I imagine there were multiple shithead dads in South Dakota at the time, probably. So.
Yeah, in Lead, South Dakota. Which yeah. I didn't even realize it was a real place, because it's the only, and I always wondered why it was the only song on the album that didn't have the in front of it.
Yeah.
And it's, I guess, because it's like the setting. Yeah. So it's like important. So it stands alone. And it's also like abbreviates to LSD. So I never was sure.
Oh, wait, is that on purpose?
I don't know. That one, I'm not sure. No one ever talks about it in anything I've ever seen. But like,
I was about to say,
in my head, I was like, maybe it's like related to that, because like,
I think a lot about of it with very, the like, clothes up. I'm pumping around with my system, pumping LSD. Good song, by the way.
It is a good song.
Heard it.
I don't really know, yeah, so, like, because it could be, but I feel like the drugs and addiction that he makes reference to are probably more for like alcohol or like.
Probably.
More like crack or meth or heroin than they are LSD.
Probably like opiates if it's
opiates,
mining
town
stuff.
Yeah.
All right, you're probably not gonna get addicted to this, but it's just highly addictive. So maybe just like seven of these a night.
Doctors in the fucking 1800s.
For your acute toe to pain. There you go.
Yeah, here's some fucking heroin.
Dude. You said you needed a another prescription? Oh, wait, why? Because you got a headache? Yeah, that's fine.
Yeah, nope. Here you go.
Here's some heroin.
A barrel of Xanax. There you go, man.
We'll get.
Please don't distribute this to anybody else. Thanks.
Don't share this, okay?
We're
this
not gonna look into it, but just please don't do it. You're on the scout's honor.
Yeah. You said you promise? All right, that's good.
All right. Yeah, so LSD, lead SD, which is a real town, apparently. It was a real mining town in South Dakota in the Black Hills.
Interesting.
But like this is where you start to really create the narrative, like the impactful part of the album on the narrator's lives. Mm-hmm. You first hear about the grocery store in this song.
Yep.
The first line, there are parts of me just stuck inside the grocery in the produce aisle where the deadbeats are rustling, trying to look busy, but they're high like me.
There are parts of me just stuck inside the grocery, the produce aisle where the deadbeats rustling, trying to look busy, but they're high like me. There are parts...
Mm-hmm. Like, we're just... fucked out of our minds right now because life's so bad. We're just high in the grocery store.
Up high in the grocery store.
Yeah, dude. Just pull up in the
that wasn't funny. High that wasn't shit. Funny. I'm gonna stop.
Oh.
Well, it's funny. Yeah, it's funnier in the context of just like being off an edible in the grocery store. But it sounds like these people are more depressingly high off of
these people are off of oxy.
They probably wish they weren't high.
but they can't stop because it's dark and cold. Is this the song where it talks about like
dark.
The snow's piling up? It was just like this time last year. Yeah, there's nothing in the wind, just white up to the trees, and it's been that way for eternity. Mm. Like that's like the hook of the song where it's like, damn, mm-hmm. just outlining like the despair of being in like a small rural area in that kind of winter where it's just snow for
months. Like of the year. I was going to say, you guys don't know anything about that, but then I'm like, oh wait, yeah, no, the actual snow. No, that's a little bit more intense, you know?
Yeah. This is temporary. I just heard I'm going to be a dad. South Dakota, every winter someone loses it. Another clue to like the major impact event. I'm lost without a single clue as to where I'm headed. I wait for her because without her, I'm going to sink. And then it's just like, I mean, the whole song is just like line after line of increasingly just sad things. And just like very depressed thought, like seasonal depressive thoughts and shit. And then the grocery Elise 13 was buried by your arrow. Steep shriek of the softball team. It rewinds me. Like a shooting has occurred in the grocery store that they're all in.
Wait. Say that line again.
The grocery Elise 13 was buried by your arrow. Steep shriek of the softball team. It rewinds me.
Oh.
Grocery. Buried by your arrow, steam shriek the softball team, it rewinds me. Will you pray for me? Repent, repeat. I'm a clock and a balance beam. If I die, there's nothing I'll keep that reminds me.
Okay, wait, that loses me a little bit. I get like there was like 13 people that died.
No, I think it was a 13-year-old girl who got killed.
Oh, wow. I'm totally missing this right now then.
Well, it's hard to like, it sounds stupid to say. It's very lyrical. It's like very lyrically, like poetically written. And it's hard to understand it just hearing it rather than seeing it.
Yeah.
But, and like, it makes more sense when you see like Elise is like the girl's name, .13, and then was buried by your arrow doesn't really make a lot of sense like hearing it, but if you can see it and kind of think about it, it's like oh, arrow is probably like a way of saying like you accidentally, or maybe not accidentally because it's a like grocery store shooter.
Yeah.
Like it sounds like someone who is having an insane mental break, but like
Yeah.
I don't know, like I actually didn't realize that they mentioned that event outside of the song The Grocery, which when you said you like that song, Jordan, I probably figured, did you, well, actually, no, did you like know what it was about? Or I know you probably really just like the instrumentation, but
yeah.
Pretty much like it's one of my favorite songs on the album because of the instrumentation and also because of, I don't know. It's arguably the heaviest song on the album, but at the same time, like every song on the album is insanely heavy.
I was about to ask if it was a reference when Jamie said it in like just lyrics in this song. I was about to ask like, oh, is that a reference to the song, The Grocery? Cause again, I'm very sorry that like a lot of meaning goes over my head, Jamie, but it is right now.
Right. No, I mean, that makes sense. But that was why, like, I wanted to look at this album because I figured there was something like here for that.
Yeah.
I mean, that's why we talk about it, you know? It's like that's where the fucking scene starts. And then it's like, it's kind of the narrator of the song, like, I think is also being shot and they're like kind of bleeding out or something, but they're just having like life revelations. Like on the floor of this grocery store, and it ends like the chorus happens again, talking about like the seasons never change; it's the same way it's always been.
Yeah,
like that. And then it ends with like you're the blood in my blood. You pretender took your blood on my blood to believe. Like maybe they had like a revelation, dying in it. I'm not really sure. The end kind of eludes me there, but yeah, it's just like holy shit. It's a weirdly heavy song.
Mm-hmm. Lead cool. South Dakota.
Huh. Yeah, and then it sets up the setting. And then the Alien's the one after that. And that's probably, I think, was the biggest song. That and the Gold
were the biggest. Okay, song. So I never really realized what he was saying at the end of that song. But if that's from the perspective of the shooter in the grocery store, it sounds like in that song he's... he's struggling to like find anything to believe in the world or like,
yeah,
it like any purpose in his life. And it sounds like that last line relates to that song, but not chronologically. Like it's earlier in the album, but it completes his thought process of the song, but it's just not actually in that song. I said that in a really confusing way, but he says, you are the blood. He says, you are the blood in my blood, you pretender. I don't really know what you pretender
is. You pretender?
I don't really know like, why that's thrown in there, but he says, it took your blood on my blood to believe. And that's the last line in the song. And that's
my blood on your blood. Blah, blah, blah.
That's true.
You are the blood in my blood. Makes him realize it's like in his dying moments, like he did something horrible and unforgivable, but it took that to make him not numb anymore, for him to realize like, oh, like we're all people and we're all like part of the same world, and we should help each other. We shouldn't hurt each other. Like, you are the blood in my blood. It took your blood on my blood to believe. Is like I hate that it took this. I hate that it took me getting to this point in my life to do something absolutely like horrible. But like that's what it took for him in his numbed state to realize that like. We're kind of all in it together. It's like a really, really dark way of looking at it. But like, to me, that's kind of what the revelation is at the end of the song there.
Which, yeah, that's kind of an interesting revelation. You know, it's like once you stop like, you know, drinking the Kool-Aid, or once you like relatability, or just like empathy. Like, you know, like the empath joke is like, you know. Mm-hmm. Alive and well right now. It's like, oh man, I totally get it because I'm an empath. It's like, you know, at some point you do just like feel things and you're like, oh, that's why, you know?
Yeah.
Like, oh shit, that's why that sucks.
Oops. Yeah, because I definitely relate to like to the sentiment of that in the mildest sense possible of like being numb from things by like reading so much like bad news all the time.
Yeah.
But
yeah.
Like you said, it's evidence of being human and like sharing like experiences and emotions with others whenever you see some event and you like actually do feel about it. You're not just like, oh, that was another headline. Like you might see like a piece of raw footage from the event or like see something from like a primary source perspective where you're like, yeah, this touched like human lives and this makes me feel horrible. you hate feeling horrible, but at the same time you recognize that like you're human along with them and that we're all struggling like through life together. But their struggle is so much worse than yours at the moment. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. That happens.
Yeah. But yeah, back to the alien.
Another very like exciting, uplifting.
Yeah.
I thought it was interesting. I just read like while we were doing the podcast, while we were recording that, I think it said that he wrote the alien. What's the next one? The Sunshine? Is that what it is? He wrote the alien, the sunshine, and the grocery all first. Those were the first songs that he wrote for the album.
Yeah.
And like, and I do love how all three of them play together because they almost all sound like one long song, especially transitioning from the sunshine to, the grocery, but like, it also transitions like very perfectly from the alien to the sunshine.
But yeah,
those three outside of the gold, and I really liked, the mistake, and I liked a lot of songs on the album, but my favorite moment in the album is the alien, the sunshine, the grocery, those three like back to back.
Yeah. There was some times where I was like, is this the end of the song or is this the next song? Cause it would literally like it did on purpose where it would just transition like perfectly over. And I would have to like look at my phone or like look at my desktop and be like, is this like, oh, okay, we're on this song now. Cause I was like, if you know, just like not looking at it, you're like, where did this, is this a new song now? Or like, has this song been going on for like 10 minutes? You know, you're like, what the fuck? Yeah. Like, I'm pretty sure this is different, but like, let me just go check. Yeah. I'm like, oh shit, two songs have already gone by. What the fuck? I have the same thing, but I do really like this and then, or those back to back again. I didn't like, I think that's where the album picks up a little bit for me. I did like the middle section a little bit more than like the beginning. The end, I'm still kind of on, you know, deciding whether it goes back down or if it like finishes out well. But as like it, I know there's a definite pickup right here for me, especially like at the alien. And I just really like his voice on this too. And just how it's not, it is a little bit of like a less intense song, like musically.
Mm-hmm.
But it is a very good song in my opinion.
Yeah. It's a really good one. And it's one where it's like, I feel like looking at the lyrics of it, you don't quite realize what's fully happening until like the third verse in it. Which is like an interesting thing where it's like, you're just listening to the setup from it. It's kind of like, I feel like Elephant by Jason Isbell. It's a much shorter time to like get to the point, but you're just thinking like, okay, this, and then there's a point where you're like, oh shit. Like, oh, that's, oh, okay. But yeah, this one's about someone trying to commit suicide by crashing their car. Where, yeah, it's, you swapped your conscience with your father's medication, limped from Rome to Lawrenceville, wrote a suicide note, and then you forced the traffic to erase your family demons. Mm-hmm. That's a crazy way of saying that.
Yeah.
To mean, like, intentionally going into oncoming traffic to die in a car accident.
The lights were low enough, you guessed. Swapped your conscience with your father's medication. Limped from Rome to Lawrenceville. And on the way wrote out a self-made declaration. When
pleasant hill. You force the traffic to erase your family demons. I made a pact with you and God. If you don't move, I swear to you, I'm gonna make you.
Dude, the songwriting is just crazy.
And it really, like, I don't know, he kind of, he illustrates this, like, bird's eye view perspective of the situation where, like, he, it sounds very intimate in that first verse where he, like, he talks about this person struggling with their own internal thoughts. And then the second verse also, the second verse is less about, like, it's still partially about that specific event happening right then, but there's also, like, flashbacks to high school when this girl's brother's main bully is the paramedic that's currently, like, saving her life after the, like, after her attempted suicide. And then in verse 3, I think it's verse 3 or the outro. Where is it? Got him.
Nicky Nick can't
right
find it.
I thought that, I don't know, maybe I'm making up memories, but
maybe I'm lying.
Maybe I'm gaslighting myself.
Those are the two, like, main perspectives of the song, or, like, her about to do what she did. Then the aftermath of what she did, like, thinking about how it relates to her past. But then also the doctor says, like, the doctor's talking to her about her ears, and that's why that's why the kids called her an alien, is because she had some kind of, like, defect with her ears that that were a result of something her dad did when she was little.
Oh, that's awful.
But then that's what it sounded like to me. I haven't completely read all the lyrics. But
yeah, no, that's like absolutely what it is.
Yeah, and then it's Christ. The last line in verse 3. It's her inner monologue. It's not the doctor talking, but it says, "Were you just finally letting go, or did you mean to take out all those people with you?" Like, her choices didn't just affect her. They affected whoever else she took down in the accident that she was, like, that she inflicted.
The lights are low enough, you guessed. Hospital food, there's never enough medication. The doctor asks about your ears. You said your mom said you were made from a revelation never scares. Your fear came from the drunken dad and a pair of scissors. Were you just finally letting go? Did you mean to take out all those people with you? Didn't mean to.
But that's kind of what I meant by bird's eye perspective of this whole situation. Like, it's like it is a very sad situation that, like, that she was internally going through, but at the same time it affected a lot of other people.
Yeah.
And she lived through it, but other people didn't.
God damn.
Yeah, it's like the doctor asks about your ears. You said your mom said that you were made from a revelation. A revelation never scares. Your fear came from your drunken dad and a pair of scissors.
Jesus Christ.
Like about the ear thing. And then, and then it's like,
Then
after it says, like, did you mean to take all those people with you? Then the chorus is just like, didn't mean to, over and over and over. And
bro,
then it's
wait.
Like wrestling with, like, God.
So, dude, that's a lot, man. I'm just realizing this. With the scissors and the ears, explain that part if you want to.
I don't know. Probably like a drunk abusive dad, like, cut up their ears or something.
Yeah,
like,
what the fuck? Jesus.
Yeah. No, it gets really heavy.
That's a lot. And then she, because of that, she, yeah, oh my gosh, she did something to self-harm, but really it took out other people.
I mean, it's like even in the second verse where it's like after the wreck has happened, and like the officers, like the high school bully of your brother, you felt some guilt that you even let him touch you.
Yeah.
And it's like, can you hear me? What's your name? You couldn't speak, just laid amazed at all the damage, like the car wreck and like the damage you've caused. And then it's like the high school's letting out. The kids are saying the same thing they used to. It's an alien. And that's
what
Yeah, it's because of like the ear thing. Yeah, dude, it's hard. And then, yeah, and then it's like, I didn't mean to. And then that's kind of the outro. And then it's like, time is here to take you by the hand and leave you there alone.
Yeah.
Time has come to take the last commandment and to carve it in your stone. Like, you're dying now. And it's
God damn.
Yeah, thinking about all of the damage and suffering that you've caused.
That's awful.
And then the sun shines a lullaby for his daughter.
That's the next.
Okay. Okay, bet. Yeah, no, that's.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's fine. That's cool. Yeah.
I did like the sunshine too.
Yeah. The sunshine was actually like it almost seems like an interlude because it's so short.
Yeah.
Like it's only 2 minutes, but I really love the bass rhythm that they have in it. And it's
it's
one of the few remotely happy songs on the album. So it sandwiched between two of the arguably most sad songs on the album. Yes. But I did love it.
I already know that I don't already know. You are sunlight. I don't really care if you don't.
Just
what are you talking about? The grocery? I thought the grocery was just him going to the grocery store buying some chicken for some buffalo chicken dip he's gonna make for the night, you know? And then you know, he's like
pre-Super Bowl.
Oh man, a free sample. That tastes so good. It's like ham or some shit, you know? Like, oh, great. That's awesome. I love that.
Yeah, I don't think they're giving samples out of this grocery store.
Hey, yeah. They're getting a sample of death. That's what we're talking about right now.
Cool.
Yeah. This one's fucking... Because this song even, like, a little bit talks about, like, the suicide attempt from the last song, I feel like. There was one section. I don't know where it is, but I swear it seemed like it was, like, related. But yeah, like the song starts out with, I don't know where I'm going, but I'm going anyway. So you leave the apartment and grab the gun under the bed. And it starts off and you're like, what the fuck? The chorus of it is like wrestling with religion. Like I want to, I want to feel the way my father felt. Is it easier for me? The chorus is beautiful. I love his singing and like it's wrestling with like, just, I don't know, religion and like the meaning of life.
I don't know where I'm going. I'm going anyways. So you leave the apartment, grab the gun under the bed. I want to reach above the paradox where nobody can see. Hold the last paradigm and strip it to its feet. I wanna feel the way my father felt. Is it easier for me? I wanna know if there's a higher love oblivious to me.
But it's sung really, really beautifully. I love the pre-chorus, according to Genius, and then the chorus as well. But yeah, it's like the narrator's like wrestling with faith and life and everything. And then the second verse is, so you walk in the grocery and you unload several rounds. So it's like you've reached the person's reached a breaking point. And this is like the grocery store shooting, like the main event.
Yeah.
At the album.
That's interesting that a different song references that. Usually, like sometimes there is like talking between songs and albums, but like not enough where it's like a direct correlation, you know? Hmm. Like maybe like, you know, there's rappers that are like talk about stuff that's happened in their lives, like maybe throughout albums or like different songs, but never like to this extent, I don't think.
Yeah.
Like they reference like a thing and then there's a whole nother song about it. It's kind of like a TV show episode, you know, where it's like,
yeah,
this thing happened, but now, oh shit, this thing happened, you know?
No, literally. Like a lot of the songs on this one are like, they reference the same major event. And then like it, like their songs that like the in Lead SD, we were talking about like the revelation that the person comes to. If it's from the point of the shooter, that's what I think Nick was kind of saying is like, that might be this person coming to the realization that they have in this song as well, in the chorus, the final outro chorus of it. They might be tied together. And it's really crazy to tie that together like that.
Yeah, very good songwriting. To only fully understand like an earlier song in the album with context of lyrics that are later in the album
is crazy.
It's a ballsy move to be like, oh, like really like it's kind of a way of being like, well, no, it's a good way to reward people who really love your music to be like the real fans and the people who really love this will notice this when they listen to it like two or three times. Or more than that, I guess, probably.
Yeah. And they have another song, another album, their 2021 album, Million Masks of God, is the same way. Like, gotcha. It's meant to be listened from start to finish, like at one, like as a whole product.
Yeah.
As well.
Not to be that guy, but Pop Smoke references a lot of the same lyrics, but in different tunes in a lot of his songs. So he'll say, like, literally, like the same two verses, but it'll be like in a different song. And you're like, okay. Okay. I'm like, oh, this is a reference to that thing. And then everybody else is like, yeah, this is just a song. And I'm just like, it's more than a song. It's a lifestyle.
It's we win.
You're a lot of shit. You get the spreadsheet. You're like, no, you don't understand. This is a cinematic universe.
No, listen, he says nut on your titties in this song and this song. Okay. I was looking through the Pop Smoke Reddit one time. It's like, what are the odds that there's a line about nutting on titties in the song, guys? And then there was.
He is widowly looking at the Pop Smoke Reddit.
Widowly? No, I was. I was. I wasn't. I haven't looked at it. Oh, I need to rejoin that.
r/
Pop Smoke, actually. You guys want to join and debate in the discussions with me?
We would get kicked out. We'd start trolling and get kicked out.
mods, excuse me,
please kick this guy out. He doesn't, dude, it's so funny.
Respect the art.
Very quick sidebar. It's so funny. Like, you're in your guys' community too, but it's like, if you say anything bad about Juice WRLD, you'll just like get vilified online by like the whole fan base. And it's probably less so with your guys' music, but like, oh my gosh, it's so funny. Like, sometimes I do just want to like go on those message boards and be like, you know, he's kind of ass, to be honest. I think everybody and then just like have everybody just mean. Like
the next comment is your home address.
You see that tweet that was like
your MAC address for your computer.
He was like making fun of Taylor Swift or somebody who has like a really big stan presence on Twitter, and they were like, he was like, yeah, honestly, like this singer's not that good. And then, like, they reply with their home address. He's like, bro, it's been 7 minutes, my God. Like, bro, it's been 7 minutes, please. It's so funny.
Yeah, that shit's always insane.
Anyway, sorry. But back to actually serious conversation.
Yeah, back to this very uplifting song. But yeah, and so, like, it's the narrator's, like, going in and committing, like, an atrocity, right? And it's then the pre-chorus is, like, wrestling with religion and God and the meaning of life. Mm-hmm. And they're like slight shifts for things. Like the first one, he's like, I want to feel the way my father felt. Is it easier for me than go in the grocery store, commit the act? Then the next one, I want to feel the way your father felt. Was it easy for belief? Mm-hmm. I want to know if there's a higher love he saw that I can't see. Mm-hmm. Looking back, it's obvious now you believe him or you don't. And then the third verse, they try to kill themselves, but the gun doesn't go off. It just like clicks. And then it's a fourth iteration of it. I want to feel the way our fathers felt when it swept them off their feet. And then the thing about, I want to know about the higher love, the only obvious equation, you believe it or you don't. And I've been trying to find the right way to get out of here. And then it's that, and that's the outro of the chorus. And it's like them coming to the revelation of like, the only way out is through kind of thing. But it's after, you know, you've committed this horrible act of terror. Like you're dying now.
Mm-hmm.
And it's like, come to the revelation. And that might be the revelation that was mentioned. Like it took your blood on my blood to like make me believe. And that this is them coming to that belief.
Yeah. Yeah. I really love
crazy,
that too.
Crazy storytelling.
The change in the phrasing from like the different pre-courses from like I to you to we basically to our belief. And that the last line, but because it sounds like he's describing all these feelings of confusion and like conflict and not knowing what to think, and the juxtaposition of that with the only obvious equation, you believe it or you don't. Like it's really black or white at the end of the day, you believe it or you don't, but there's all this like internal monologue of whether or not to choose to believe it or not, or for it to like waiting for it to reveal itself to you. Like I don't know, it really really struck me.
Yeah. It very much, and his delivery of it as well. Like I don't think the song would hit as hard if he didn't sing the like those lines how he did. Like, yeah. It really feels like a moving, impactful, and emotional like journey that you're going on as well.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's a song where it's one of the ones where if you're in like the right headspace and really listening to it, it definitely can like make you kind of cry a little bit.
Yeah, because right after he says like the only obvious equation, you believe it or you don't, he yells out don't, and then I'm pretty sure the next part isn't a line, it's just basically just him yelling into like all the instruments exploding, and then
yeah,
and then after that it's almost him like yelling the lyrics again about I've been trying to find the right way to get out of this.
Yeah, but,
yeah, I mean outside of yeah. Yeah, I mean,
that shit's crazy.
Yeah,
not that much shit's more to crazy say. For real, though. I don't even know.
That shit crazy, and then the wolf is like another, like it's still continuing the narrative a little bit.
Mm-hmm. Okay,
but it's also really good. Yeah, because it starts off like Christmas lights dangled sadly from the table in the operating room. Last I heard, you're an addict about it, full of rage and Corona, trying to blow the birthday kid candles out, mm-hmm. like. Taking out your frustration on other people and all this stuff. And then it's like, if you're going, bring some faith and a flashlight, follow the signs that read it's 20 miles before you finally see fire. But it's talking about like, and then it's like going out to where our extended family bury their lies. Like all the shit of like, every family's got secrets and yeah. like skeletons in the closet.
Skeleton.
And it's wrestling with all that. And then there's like a thing that's like, you may be paying too much for your life insurance policy. Like that's just thrown in, separating that.
Dude, honestly, that's some like rap music type shit.
Yeah.
This is a prepaid collect call from, and it's like the worst fucking microphone ever because from a county jail. It's like, yeah. Like, what did he just say? What the heck?
And then it gets a little weird. Now, there's something to say for the art of confusion. I got the courage to inquire where your body traveled all the time. I got to climb out of this elevator. Hadn't moved me once. Do I expect that it should really start now?
Did you say confusion?
Confusion? I guess it's like more afterlife stuff. He said that he was inspired to write this after a night out for someone's birthday party where everyone was, as Andy said, next level drunk. And I was thinking about how no one would remember what happened. And then the line that's like, couldn't think it to words and watched your body lift up to the sky. Everyone was just in awe about it. Seen a miracle and drank away the thought.
Damn.
Just like weird writing where I don't know really.
Uh-huh.
What? Just like, I guess we're so like numb to whatever. I don't know. But the fucking, chorus of it, this is the wave you can never conquer, losing the smallest piece of truth we used to know. I wasn't prepared to embark with the wolf of the mountain. It wasn't a place that we could call our own. Like, I wasn't prepared to die and go into the afterlife. Because the wolf of the mountain, I think, is a religious thing, maybe? Or an allusion to... this person says it may be an allusion to Dante's Inferno when he's climbing the Mount Purgatory.
Oh,
this passage barred by three feral animals, one of which is a wolf.
Interesting.
I don't know.
Also?
But...
Oh, sorry, go ahead.
Yeah, but the second verse, see the pain on the wall, see the blood in the street. That's like the grocery store terror act. And then the blood on the street is also a callback probably to the like motor, like vehicular suicide.
Yeah, yeah.
From the alien. There's nothing you've got when you die that you keep. You are all that you were you all you could be? In the blink of an eye, there's a hole in your belly. Your body recoils ironically into the family planning aisle.
Bro, but real quick,
that's
crazy. Wait, say that line again.
So you were all that you were you all that you could be? In the blink of an eye, there's a hole in your belly. Your body recoils ironically into the family planning aisle. Over here, I don't know where I'm going. I'm going anyway. Don't let them tell you that I never found. And then it cuts off, probably when the gunman is shot by like police or someone else or something.
Yeah.
Jesus.
It's crazy, dude. And then it goes on again, like you and me and nothing between. It's right and wrong. It goes on and on and on.
Yeah.
So truthfully, do you want to die for me? And then again about like, I wasn't prepared to embark with the wolf on the mountain. Like I wasn't prepared to die.
Yeah.
Going to the afterlife. Damn. It's just wild. No, you do not pick that up from that song if you don't really sit down and look at it.
No. Also, I was saying, you're talking about like very introspective and like how like, you know, like heaven or like sending like the Dante. I was saying like, you said it was confusing. And I said it was Confucius, like it was Confucian, you know, like Confucius, like
Confucian wisdom.
Like, yeah, like the wisdom, like the, of, you know, whatever. Anyways, that was the
man on fire. He's warm for the rest of his life.
Stop, bro.
My favorite fucked up idiom.
That was a bad joke. But anyways, yeah, no, that's like the instrumentation of that song is just so good. And now the story is also good. Originally I liked it mostly because of the instrumentation. Yeah. Like I'm not gonna be like, I read into this and I knew that it was talking about design. What is it? You know, like I definitely just liked it just because I think I like just like the song, but it definitely has way more meaning than I thought. And that even adds more. That even adds to my likeness. Like I think I'm actually gonna like this song, and add it to my like songs. Actually,
Hell yeah, dude! You know, let's do it.
Crazy from a non-rap.
Play album. It for somebody like, yo, this song.
Yeah,
it's about an act of terror and.
I fucks hard with the Mania Orcs, bruh. Okay,
Mania Orcs.
I fucks hard with it.
Dude, this is such a crazy album.
I harness many arcs. Anyways.
Yeah, no, it's a good, it's just more excellent songwriting that also goes with great music. Nick, you said you liked The Mistake a lot, right?
Yeah, but basically just from like an instrumentation standpoint, I think it it has like a little synth in the, wait. Yeah. It has like this kind of like techno-y electronic synth noise like underlying most of the song that I just kind of liked. But it also like in the kind of general sense I got from the lyrics. Yeah, everybody I know makes the same mistakes, packaged up in different boxes, masking shame. I think that's the chorus. Yeah.
Yeah.
Like I don't know. It's just kind of like a kind of like an equalizing emotional song in the sense that a lot of the other ones are.
Shame.
of course, with a very sad and gloomy aura, but it kind of points to a similar message that's in a lot of the other songs, that we're all going through shit. Like, we should try and understand that and help each other out rather than siloing ourselves and like focusing on our own internal despair.
Yeah.
Couldn't have said it better myself.
We shouldn't do that. We shouldn't do that is what I'm saying.
You know, I think you said we should do that.
And you're saying we should isolate ourselves and only live individualistically.
No, it's better when you're vulnerable. Please hear that.
shout that from the rooftops. It's better when you're vulnerable. Mm-hmm. It's better when you cry together.
There's a reason that virtually all mass shootings are caused by straight white men. It's because they're too proud to discuss any of their trauma or emotions with other people.
So they take it out on everyone else.
Yep.
If I'm not happy, no one can be. I don't know. Sorry, that's not even funny. I'm not even joking about it. That's like literally like just how it is, dude.
Yeah, it's fucked up, man.
Forchi.
Yeah, and then I think the outro references again, because the whole thing is talking about like the shame, don't isolate. I think the outro, it doesn't talk about the shooting, but it talks about like the like, I think it kind of have three lines that throw back to the person who tried to commit suicide, mm-hmm. like dying. Talks about now the wheels are falling off the car beside the 100-meter grave in the yard. Everybody here feels sorry for us. Mm-hmm. And then he goes into the parts, which is a very beautiful love song to his wife.
Cute.
I like it.
Scoot.
It's a scoot. Turn off the alarm, wonder where you are. I'd be a page in your book if you let me. Mm. Very,
very, there you go.
Very lot of range. A lot of range on this album.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
love songs
for sure.
To
love songs, lullabies for his newborn daughter, and then like horrifically sad, depressing things.
Yeah, apparently, dude. Apparently,
so makes, I thought makes it was you feel shit.
I thought it was really funny in the parts where he says, "And I'm your water boy." He's talking about his wife giving birth, and
yeah, like just being on the sidelines, like, yeah, you know, like, if you need anything,
you're here for support.
I got that, you.
You're doing great, very, babe.
That's a very funny and smart way to put it in few words. Like, I'm a water boy, overwhelmed by the screaming, your clenched teeth, nails dug deep into my meaning.
Yeah. Yep. Like, you and the miracle of life are giving me purpose. Mm-hmm. And here I am just fucking.
Yep.
Give it 13 years. Both your legs up, you're crying. Trying to push your life out from your belly. And I'm a water boy, overwhelmed by the screaming. Your clenched teeth, nails dug deep into my meaning.
Let me know if you need anything. I got you, babe.
Yeah, just dig your nails into my hand, and I've got a cup of water in the other. Let me know if you need.
There you go, babe. There you go.
But it's good. And the chorus of, I still want to know each part. I want to know each part of you. Yeah, I still want to know each part. I want to know each part of you. Just like, you know, it's been over 13 years. We started off Britney Spears' yellow SUV, and then now we're having kids and like doing shit.
There you go.
And I still love you. Which is, it's nice. This is where I feel like the album transitions from like, there's a bunch of sad shit, but it's not all bad.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And that's where it starts with the love song and then the silence, which is like a 7-minute long masterpiece.
With the extremely sad and horrible things that go on all the time in our wonderful country and well, all across the world.
Yeah.
There's also beautifully amazing things that happen throughout your life.
Yeah. Yeah. It's no T-Pain's love song, but, you know, or yeah, the best
it's
love song in the world, whatever that song is.
It's close. All right.
It's close.
Yeah, but I like the silence is, I mean, like I said, it was originally the reason why I really got into this album again and wanted to do it.
Yeah.
Because I was like, there's something here. And then turns out the whole album is there's something here. but yeah, I love the way it builds just energy and lyrically through the whole thing, like questioning things. Mm-hmm. This is like wrestling with God. And then like, I think finding God. But I really, really love, again, it's the lyrics slightly change over and over throughout it as mm-hmm. time and the concept progresses. And it's all really, really good. But like the guitar and the bridge and then the outro of it are just like beautiful mm-hmm. lyrically and musically. It's just basically.
I'm just reading part of the outro right
yeah.
now. It's very, very powerful. Let me watch you as close as a memory. Let me hold you above all the misery. Let me open my eyes and be glad that I got here.
There's nothing you keep. There is only your reflection.
Yep.
And like the fucking, there's nothing but quiet retractions and families pleading. Don't look in the cabinet. There's far more bad than there's good. I don't know how it got there. Of something your father burned into me 20 hours out of home stake eternity. You can go anywhere, but you are where you came from. Little girl, you are cursed by my ancestry. There is nothing but darkness and agony. I can not only see, but you stop me from blinking. And then, yeah, they'll let me watch you as close. Where it's like, I all of our families and all of the past, their skeletons in that closet, it's all mm-hmm. fucked up. Like, no matter how far away you go, it's still in your DNA. You're cursed by my ancestry. There's nothing but darkness and agony.
Right. That sounds like a BoJack lyric for sure.
Yeah. I mean, yeah. But then, and then it's like, but you know, you've illuminated to me that there is more beauty in life and that there is more than just the past.
Never mind. Not a BoJack.
I'm hoping that, I can help you, you know, course correct and we can be like good from here on out. Show me that.
Yeah.
It's like, and eventually the album ends in a note of like redemption.
But yeah, did you know
part right there, him screaming that part is like in concert. I like almost started crying. I was like, holy shit.
What are you saying?
Very good.
Subconsciously, this is why you like the album, Jordan.
Honestly? Yeah,
your brain's not telling you, but it's picking up on the BoJack themes.
Dude, there's no BoJack. BoJack doesn't have redemption, okay? It's supposed to be sad. It's supposed to be depression porn for people that never want to fix their lives and relate to. You're not supposed to relate to BoJack because he never fixes anything. But the other characters, you get. Anyways, So I've read a lot of lore. Dude, I literally watch like fucking like the BoJack edits on YouTube that are like 7 minutes long. It's just like some like song. It's like the saddest part compilation. It's not even, it doesn't even say it's like a sad part compilation. It's like reality, but with like a space in between like each like letter.
Oh God.
So
it's all lowercase spaces.
No, literally.
They put in like a rain overlay.
No, they do. They literally do that.
Yeah. Well, next time you're in that mood, you know, bump some of the problem. You'll feel it.
Oh my God, they literally do that.
That's so fucking funny.
It's like sad Bart Simpson edits.
Yeah, Bart Simpson, dude. The sad Bart Simpson edits.
Sorry, you were too, like, it's just such a it's such a trope that it's like, God, it's so funny.
Oh, man. Yeah.
But I know what I'm getting though, so that's why I watch them.
Yeah, that's true. I mean, that makes sense. I mean, that's why I listen to this kind of music. I know what mood it's going to put me in if I listen to
it. Oh my gosh, that's really funny. Sorry,
you made me laugh. But yeah, it's just a beautiful way to end the album. It's one of my favorite songs by them overall. I really love this song.
I was surprised that it almost has as many streams as the gold.
Yeah.
What?
That is, yeah, because the gold and the alien were the ones that got radio play.
Yeah, dude, I'm surprised.
The sunshine is the third most streamed. What the hell?
Right? It has more than the alien?
Yeah.
I don't know. It's good, but like that's, I don't know.
Yeah.
Maybe like if you fuck with it, you really fuck with it kind of thing.
I think The Grocery was a really good song, but I guess now I realize why it didn't get like more popularity because of like subject yeah. matter. I was like, why did this one not get as much? I was like, oh,
yeah, that's why. That one, The Wolf and Lead SD, you're like, these are really good. Why is it so low? And then you're like, oh, because they're like mind-numbingly sad.
Oh, because when you learn the lyrics enough to sing them, you don't want to sing them anymore.
Yeah, you start, you're not really sitting there with The Grocery, like, you load your gun and put it in your mouth and then it clicks. Like you're not really,
you're
sitting there bumping that shit.
I feel like I'm out of my mind. I feel like
I'm like out of my mind.
Who can relate?
Yo, Logic is so deep for this one. I'm not even joking. You can check out the new Logic.
But I love the silence. And that kind of concludes my notes. Other than I'm glad that it seems like this was generally well received by you guys. Nick, I know you had listened to it before, but not really.
Yeah, I guess it was well received by me.
And I'm glad we finally talked about it before it became spring and summertime for me.
True.
Because I would not have been able to really emotionally grapple with this when it's like 70 degrees outside.
That's so crazy to me. I like that you listen based off like season. I've never done that in my whole life.
I don't exclusively do that. I definitely used to do it more. but no, it very much like... It's more so now with the music that I'm like, I don't know what I want to listen to. I'm just going to put something on.
Okay.
Like, it's not like I'm intentionally listening, but I'm like, I'll go back to like, this is my fallback. And the fallbacks typically seem to change with the seasons now.
Makes sense.
It definitely used to be like everything I listened to would change with the season. Mm-hmm. But now it's more so like just kind of my default music, I think of it as.
Yeah.
Kind of trends.
I got you.
Based on what's going on outside. Finally out of my blonde era.
So that's hey, simple up? Size like Chanel. I keep on buying like Papa.
Right, it was kind of warm. Like a couple of weeks ago, it was like 50 at night. Oh. I sat on the balcony listening to Chanel.
Oh, boy, it was kind of warm the other day. It was 50 degrees.
Yeah, no, dude. It is currently 50 degrees right now. When I walked the dogs this morning, it was 36. God.
Okay. How do you just like adjust that quickly? I just don't get it. Like 50 degrees is cold here.
This is my outfit.
But like, how does that like, how do you, like, how do you go from living in NC and like that being like that? And now you're just like, yeah, it's like this, you know?
I mean, it was brutal. It helped that our first winter out here was more mild. And then this year has been way worse, but apparently this is more the norm
for
Denver, Colorado winters. Yeah. So like, I think it snowed, big snowed like two or three times last year, winter. But here, there's still snow in the part that's always shadowy by our dumpsters.
Whoa.
That snow, I'm pretty sure, is from the first one that was like early November. Like, it just hasn't fully melted.
But there's been stuff adding to it, though, correct?
Yeah, exactly. And
okay. But that's still crazy though.
There's a pile that's been over towards like, it's like where they plow the little small roadway and it builds like the little icebergs and it's all just like black and gray. Yeah. And you're like, was this ever white at any point? And that part has been, it's finally almost melted. That one has been there since November because I think when we were back home it was when we were in Florida a couple of weeks ago. Because I follow the Weather Channel on Twitter. It was like, this has been the longest since snow first started falling that there hasn't been snow. And it was like 3 weeks or 4 weeks for like this season. So yeah, it's cold, but it means anytime it's above like 55, I'm wearing shorts and a crew neck. And if it's above 70, I'm wearing short sleeves and if it's above 60, I'm wearing short sleeves and a t-shirt. In the daytime, it still gets cold because like without the sun, there's no atmosphere here to hold in heat with humidity. So once the sun's gone, you're like, oh, I'm putting on layers. But
makes sense.
Like we're gonna get coffee after this because it's 12. This is probably what I'm gonna wear to the coffee shop.
There you go.
And maybe most wanted stash.
Oh yes, it's Julian Salamita's merch.
Don't even know who that is. Oh, is that Jenna Marble's boyfriend?
Jenny and Julian. Yeah. Fiance, maybe husband. I think they're married now.
Bro, how did I know that? The only name I know of a Julian is like, I don't know how I had that information in my head because I've never watched
a video of his. It's either him or the Strokes. Yeah, it's either him or Casablancas, I feel like.
But I don't know who I barely listen to any of the Strokes music, so I'd forget who that lead singer is, to be honest.
No, you should. Julian does some streams. He's pretty funny. I like him. He's a good content creator. I don't like watch his videos that much, but you know.
But you just bought his merch? Vic
bought it for me. Yeah, because I like him as a person. He seems like I want to grow up to be him. You know.
Oh, interesting.
A role model.
Yeah. I don't have any more notes for the album. If we
want. I make my own coffee now, actually.
Me too, but I also still enjoy the vibe of a coffee shop. So you know, do a little bit of both.
People who buy coffee stay poor.
Yes, MF the woke buys, libs.
MF buys one espresso machine off. Well, actually, you have two, but one of them you didn't buy.
Dude, one of them, I'm pretty sure she paid, like, the person who gave it to me, it was my ex-girlfriend's roommate. It's like, it was probably like $30. I have to, like
looking at it, yeah.
Legitimately $30. And it would, like, it's an espresso machine, but would fill up for, like, four cups. It had a coffee, like, holder underneath it. Yeah. But it would have the amount of an espresso at the top, you know? But
so did it just make really watery coffee?
Not like watery. Watery's not the word because it was still strong. Like I could still taste the coffee flavor. But it was a lot less. You know how, again, I would never know this if I didn't look into getting espresso. But apparently pressure matters a lot when making espresso. Nick, I didn't know if you, maybe Jamie did. I don't know if you knew that, but like a regular espresso machine usually is like 15 to 20 bars of pressure. And like that one is an espresso machine, but it's like 2 bars of pressure, you know? So like, like it was still making espresso.
It's like a weird combination of like pour over and like an espresso machine.
Yeah. Because it wouldn't make a pot of coffee,
but it wouldn't make a pot of coffee
and it was still strong enough where I could mix it with things, you know, and it still tastes like I can mix it with like oat milk and I can still taste the coffee in it, you know? Mm-hmm. Anyways. I don't know.
But yeah, you just got to find the right coffee shop and then the vibe's right. And you're like, oh shit, I'm going to.
Oh yeah, there's a lot of good coffee shops in Raleigh. I kind of want to go to more, but.
Yeah, that's one thing I want to go to more whenever we go back. We'll be back. Maybe the only time we'll be back is for Bonner.
Jubala, right above NC State, underrated. It's good.
That's bro, what, I feel like it's overrated.
Our friend,
I gotta say, all my homies hate Cup of Joe. All right, Cup of Joe L.
I haven't. I've drank it both ways. Okay. We're on a date at Jubala.
I just know the management is like kind of shitty. So.
Oh really?
Oh, is it? I didn't know that.
Oh yeah, who do we?
Damn.
I think did one of our mutual friends work at Cup of Joe?
We had a friend whose roommate worked at Cup of Joe.
Who?
My Yeah, yeah, yeah. I know about her and Sue's my girlfriend used to work there for like.
Oh.
She worked there for like just a bit, and she said they were just like super micromanaging and kind of douche.
I feel like I know somebody else who worked at Compagio. I can't remember right now.
Probably it's probably a pretty popular like employment opportunity.
Yeah, I've heard from my girlfriend and from like the person you mentioned, Jamie, and and I think my girlfriend also said that she knew a couple of other people who just said they didn't have good experiences working there. Yeah. And one of the owners of Jubala is one of the owners of like the Benchwarmers Enterprises.
I thought you were about to say Bolted Bread. Yeah,
Benchwarmers Bolted and Bright Spot, the donut place. Like all the other like
I had bench- two of three of those things. I've not had the donuts.
Yeah, I want a Benchwarmer bagel at some point, Nick.
Oh, you've never had one?
No.
Are the only thing I've had there. They're very good.
Like
the pizza is also very good, but the bagels are like amazing.
We have had the pizza, but like, is it gonna have like stuff on it, or is it just like a plain bagel?
Oh, they got stuff on it.
Like, yeah. But like meat and stuff in the middle, or like.
Yeah,
you know,
yeah, okay. That's kind of their specialty. Like you can also get like just like a bagel with cream cheese, but like they have like 10 different, close to 10 different like normal bagel sandwiches like listed on their menu with like crazy ingredients that you wouldn't see at other bagel shops. And then usually they have like a special every weekend that's usually really good. I usually get the special because it's usually like some whipped up crazy concoction that turns out.
I know, dude. I want to try. We should start going.
One
for
time
bagels.
I got like a crazy. Actually, two. One time I got like a. It was like a braised lamb neck, with okra and some other stuff, and it was like
what the fuck?
It was just like a really fancy sandwich on a bagel, and it was amazing.
Yeah.
And that's some crazy. like bagel purists don't love their bagels because they're like wood fired and stuff. they're like my favorite bagels. Like
bagel purists,
even compared to like all the New York bagels that I had, I still like Benchwarmers better. But like
really, because that's like the one thing I say all the time whenever I have bagels. I'm like, this is so good, but a New York bagel is still undefeated to me.
Yeah, I got kind of a bad taste in my mouth because like the first. Bagel that I had in New York was definitely old. I bit into it and I was like, "There's no way this is like what all of them taste like." And then I was
no
like, "This is,"
this
I was
is
like, "This is like
eat.
Chewy as hell." Like,
But
then I had like a really good one the next day. But I think I only had two while I was in New York. But I liked Benchwarmers better. So that's all that I based my.
Did you get a?
Did you have any pizza in? New York?
Oh yeah, it was amazing. Yeah,
bro,
oh,
tell yeah. me, tell me, you got the ketchup and salt and pepper on the bagel with the bacon, egg, cheese.
No, I didn't get anything to occupy.
You gotta get the pork roll with the egg and cheese, ketchup, salt and pepper.
No,
actually, all you need on a bagel is just corned beef and mustard.
I thought it was the bacon, that's egg, and cheese.
That would also be good.
Bacon, egg, cheese.
But I ate like lox bagels, so I didn't do like the ketchup, salt, pepper, and stuff. But
you didn't put ketchup on your salmon, dude.
But the other Benchwarmers bagel I had that was a special was it was like fish that was like pickled in white wine, like maybe white wine vinegar, I guess. Either pickled or just marinated and soaked, I guess. But and then it had like cut up white grapes on it with like cream cheese and other stuff on it, and that was like unlike anything
grapes
I'd
and fish.
Ever had. Interesting. Yeah. It was very good.
I mean, I guess like fish goes a lot with like white wine, and that's grape flavored.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Uh huh.
Weird.
Yeah. But yeah, we can probably go like next weekend, Jordan. I'd be down.
I'm down next weekend. Yeah, we can. I might be.
If you're here,
let's just no. I'm gonna be here. I might be doing something still though. But
one of these days,
either way,
we'll be back in Raleigh, and we can. Reunite for weekend food.
Reunited.
It'll be a couple years, but you know.
Sorry, that's like a punch up in the air. Anyways, maybe blur that out.
Slow mo.
I think you were trying to do the democratic appropriation. That still was fucking maybe the wildest display of like virtue signaling I've ever seen.
Dude, wait, like the
all
bigger
the
lady
lawmakers getting down on a knee.
Oh yeah.
Or like the TikTok where they would like
here's
paint like the symbol on their face.
Yeah.
Oh God. Funny.
Racism is over.
Oh my gosh, it's
that
so funny.
That ad will like forever just be in pop culture. I feel like.
Yep.
So funny.
Thank you, Kendall Jenner.
Thank you.
Now
Kendall
let us watch
Jenner
you cut a cucumber.
Fucking Pepsi. Let us watch you what?
Have you seen that video of her trying to cut a cucumber and she like can't do it? She like can't figure
no,
it out.
No, what?
You gotta look it up.
Cut a cucumber?
It's obvious that she's never sliced a cucumber in her life.
All right, that's going on the mood board. This is one of those episodes where it's like, what the fuck do I put on the mood board for this one?
Yeah.
Just saying shit at the end.
Put the number
from
the number for the suicide hotline.
Yeah, honestly, clips with fucking the Michael Keaton thing about the opoid epidemic, that like miniseries they did, the docuseries.
God, what is that called? Dope Sick? Is that what it's called?
Dope Sick, yeah, it sounds right. Sounds right. Something like that. Just put that on there, fucking I don't know, the Black Hills of South Dakota, I guess.
Lead South Dakota.
I don't know. But yeah, so I guess we can do ratings for this one and then Jordan can announce next week's episode. For me, probably again, unsurprisingly, this is a 10. It was going to be a 9.8, and then, I don't know, just drawing more parallels and connections while talking about this, the songwriting is like otherworldly.
There you go. So. I think I'm going to go 9 on my end.
Wow. I think I'm going to go 5.5.
Beautiful.
Nice. I really thought it was going to be in the 3s for you, so that, you know.
Bro, I'm expanding my taste now.
Yeah, I respect.
After going to the record store punk shows. You're
oh my gosh, dude. they're actually crazy. Man. And actually, funny enough, I don't think this will get out anywhere because not many people listen to this, but my...
What do you mean, dude? We have millions of listeners.
When we blow up, you're going to regret this.
I think I have more people that listen to this than like you guys. Like I've honestly just casually mentioned to some of these people that like I've been like on dates with, or some people I haven't even seen, and they'll just send me like,
oh, I haven't. I'm embarrassed to tell people I have a podcast.
Well, dude, you're the one who. No, I'm kidding. But I'm like, I do it, and they're like, they sometimes send me shit, like just like months later, randomly, and they're just like listening to it. They're like, LOL, and I'm like, bro, why are you sending me that? I don't want to know this shit, but like, it's still funny, you know. Yeah. But I'm like,
I will have that where people would be like, oh shit, like. You know, this thing happened. I thought this was really funny, or I like this. And I also feel like that's why I like making the TikTok clips as well. I feel like it's more approachable that way as well. Because there are some of those that actually get like decent views and likes and shit.
What I was going to say is some person that I dated, like I don't talk to anymore, is now the girlfriend of one of the bands we went and saw, of the lead singer now. Small world. Just like a small world kind of thing, you know?
It's a small world.
It's a blue world.
Bro, I've been listening to Circles again. And
he moved from Blonde to Circles.
I literally couldn't hear Nick. It was like you were flooding the data rate of this call that Discord had allotted, so I just couldn't hear Nick at all.
You DDoS Discord?
Nick's like...
Dude, literally, that's what it was. I could hear Nick's voice every now and then come through.
Sorry, that was funny.
But you were
just...
You were pegging the data rate with your voice. You just fully filled.
Pegging?
What's the baud rate? So that brings it to an average of 8.17, which puts it at 11th overall. It is just below 21 by Adele.
21,
just
20.
Above Dreamland by Glass Animals.
Heat wave, look at me.
Yes.
I want more coffee right now.
I need to eat something. I feel like my coffee is like hitting the caffeine's like hitting the weird spot in my brain where I'm like, oh yeah, I definitely need more in my stomach.
Oh, this is a little weird. I'm about to get weird.
Nah, dude. I had egg rolls and a breakfast hot pocket for breakfast, bro. I'm Gucci.
Breakfast of champions.
I'm Gucci, bro.
Right, yeah, I guess it's like lunchtime now for you guys, right? It's like 2?
Yeah. Yep. I mean, lunchtime was like 2 hours ago, but... Yeah, I guess it...
I believe in the 1 p.m. lunchtime. Actually, yeah, I believe whenever I'm hungry, that's when lunch. when she's
honestly
up.
Yeah.
So sometimes it's 11:30. Sometimes it's three.
You know? Oh.
Sometimes you're just like, don't eat. Yeah. Sometimes you're like, why am I so annoyed at everything? I haven't eaten and it's 7 p.m.
Like, why does my head hurt all day? Oh, that's why. Okay, let me try to eat something.
Oh, because I have consumed no calories.
Only in liquid form.
So what are we listening to next week, Jordan?
We are listening to ... by the one and only Ice Spice.
The King of New York.
King of New York, the new King of New York. Yeah, I know.
Queen of New York.
Yeah, I know.
Apologies.
Wait, Queen of New York you meant, right?
Yep, I did.
Why do you feel the need to gender it?
Queen of Jordan's heart.
Interesting.
There we go.
I do love Ice Spice. I was on the Ice Spice train just a tad early, you know, just a tad.
Boy's a liar.
Does it ever feel? But that's so funny. I was telling Jamie which one we were listening to, and I was like what? Because I thought it was called what, which she says a lot. And Jamie's like, wait, what's the album? I was like, question mark. He's like, yeah, what are you? And I'm like, bro, that's the album.
The second time I got it when I asked again, but the first one, because you said like, and you said like what? And he said like, and then that was it. You didn't say like, oh, my bad, it's actually this.
Yeah, so yeah, yeah.
Like, okay, which one is it? And then you're like.
I was like. Oh, okay. I see that.
I was like, I know one of those is the album.
The conversation just looks funny, you know? And I also didn't tell you who... Wait, did I tell you who... I told you who the artist was, right?
I think...
I definitely did, because... which I was like, probably if he goes to discography, he could find it, even if I get the name a little bit wrong, but it's like... I totally get not doing that, though, too. I was
feeling lazy.
No, I know, dude, trust me, I'm... You're talking to the lazy king right now, all right? Like, I get it. It was just funny back and forth, you know?
Yeah, it is one of those ones where written, it's just like, it looks like everyone's confused.
Like...
But yeah.
You thought I was feeling...
For my recent listings, the new Paramore album is very good.
I need to listen to that still.
Yeah, dude, this is why, like, it was the lead single... And it's the first song. It's really good, though. It's very, very fun. That shit's going to go crazy at Bonnaroo. I already know it.
Oh,
and I recently checked out Gloria, Sam Smith's album. And it's also really good.
Nice.
I don't know why I hadn't listened to it, but it's very good. Interesting. And then I've listened to some of his other stuff as well. But yeah, that's mostly been it.
Doesn't he have like a really... choir focused song on that album, or is the whole album kind
Gloria,
of like
body baba, God's getting hot at the body.
No, that's unholy, and that one bangs. They played that at the company party. Dude. Me and Vic and like four other people were vibing to it. Everyone else was
that
like
that song
35 years old and confused.
No, that song, the chorus is good, the song is so bad, dude.
I think all things good. I really like it. It's fun.
Yeah. Dude, I don't know how you think that.
Daddy, if you want to drop the addy.
No, dude, it's so, it's so bad.
Yeah, Gloria, the song on the album is entirely just like, it's like a chorale with him and a choir, and it's really good.
Golden.
I saw him perform. I saw the performance of it on SNL, and I was like,
okay.
I was like, this is a Sam Smith song? Like, it sounds like he's just like singing with a choir, but like it was really cool. Is. And then I think like Sharon Stone like comes out of a casket or something. Sharon like, Stone. It was wild. It was pretty cool.
I don't know. It's really funny because that song is followed by one of my favorite songs on it. That could like I really hope to hear it in a club sometime because it's him, Calvis Harris, and Jesse Reyes. Like it's like a groovy disco club beat, and then that song ends, and then. Oh, like it's crazy. It's very funny.
I sound like you're about to sing Kung Fu Fighting, dude.
Oh. It also sounds like I was going with.
Oh yeah, this sounds like a theme song. This sounds like something that would be on like the funk wave bounces, Calvin Harris shit. I like
that. Yeah,
it bangs, dude. That song is in my like groovy playlist now.
Yeah.
Hey, we fell in love.
Yeah, All right.
Yo, okay. Yo, what is up, guys? I'll be listening to my frequent listenings this week. What have I been listening? Let me actually look at my, I always go to my on repeat because that's a more, a better one. Oh, God. My number one is Washing Machine Heart by Mitski because Arden was listening to it. Like, like we both have like songs that we just listen to over and over again. Uh-huh. God damn, now it's going to be on my fucking Spotify rap because I was just playing it for her through my desktop speakers all day. Anyways. But yeah, so, oh, Dragostea Dentai. That's been my stimming song of the week.
The hell
I don't
is
know
it?
If you if you know what that is. You know the Numa Numae, Numa Numa Numae, E por caos, Lagos Larid. You know that song? Uh-uh. Okay, you know the song where it's like the Numa Numa guy where it's like Resetas
Numa Numae? I think so.
You know it, dude. Anyway, there's like a hard metal cover of it, and it's so good. I'll actually share it to the people real quick, so you can just get a little taste of it while I'm doing it. Boy's a Liar Part 2, been renting that song. Under the Sun, still, I love Under the Sun. That song is so good.
The Revenge of the Dreamer song?
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, hell yeah.
That song is still just like, I know it's a good song, but I like get out of it and then I listen to it again. I know you have songs like that. I'm just like,
yeah.
Oh, man, this song is
That is a really good song.
What?
That is a really good song.
Yeah.
I forgot about it.
Been listening to, I think I did say it last week, but less this week, but still listen to Off the Grid a lot. Not as much, but Fabio's verse still just gives me that, you know? Rubbing Off the Paint by YB and Namir. P-Power. Yesterday by Chief Keef here and there. Some of the new ones, though. I'm trying to think of the ones that I've been listening to that I haven't. Oh, I added a song that already got taken off of Spotify. Like, like it recommended it to me. It's by SSG Kobe. And I was like, oh, let me like this to listen to it. It's like my fourth one down. I think I did it like yesterday and it's already taken off. That's insane. Not sure why. Oh, I was listening to Cats in the Cradle and Father and Son because I was trying to show Arden some of like the dad and son songs. And Cats in the Cradle. You know that song, right?
That's like the Yusuf Cat Stevens song.
Yeah.
Right? Yeah.
So good, dude. Also, I don't know if you've ever heard Rainy Days and Mondays by the Carpenters.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Claire showed me that song in high school and I kind of forgot about it, but I really love that song too.
Okay.
Yeah, Rainy Days and Mondays always get me. I'm surprised you know that, to be honest. It is like old. It is really good song, obviously. Yeah. So I'm not like, you know, too surprised, but I'm like,
the only reason I know it is because I think my girlfriend told me about it because...
Oh, really?
Yeah, the singer for Japanese Breakfast, Michelle Zahner, in her book talks about listening to that song with her mom a lot, like before her mom died.
Uh-huh.
And we listened to it in the car, and I was like, man, this is a really good song.
Damn, like, wait, so you just like... Like recently listened to it as in like the last like year or so?
Yeah, like the last year. Yeah.
Oh damn, yeah. That's crazy. Oh, yeah. I've also Oh wait, sorry, what were you gonna say?
No, you're good. That was it.
I was gonna say last one is I've been listening to Take On Me, the MTV unplugged version where it's like that acoustic. Do you know what I'm talking about?
No, I haven't heard it.
You've never heard that version?
No. There's an unplugged version of Take On Me by like Aha.
Yeah.
Really?
Dude, I'm telling you.
I'm checking it out.
No, okay,
I gotta look at that.
I'll also share that too. It changes the song. Like it is unlike anything. Like it is not like it is such a different vibe than the actual original song. It is so good though. It is so good. Like it is like sad almost listening. Like you will maybe cry listening to it. Maybe not that much, but it's very emotional. I feel like.
I think I've actually seen the video for it before. Like part of
you,
it.
I feel like you had to. It's like kind of crazy.
First, I'm going to have to listen to it, Rainy Days and Mondays. So it's a good song. But were you all finished?
Yeah.
Were you all done?
I'm done.
Okay. Yeah, I pretty much me. I've just been listening to podcasts. The new Andy Schaaf album Norm is very, very good. At least lyrically, I feel like Jamie, you would like it. There's a bit more experimentation with synths on the album, and one of the primary narrators. Well, two of the primary narrators. One is a one is Norm, and you start to see unfolding in the album how much of a creep he is. And one of the other primary narrators is God, so
I should check it out, and I should also give Neon Skyline. I should give it another try because now I listen to a wider array of music since we did that. Maybe I would like appreciate the music as well as the lyrics.
Well, more. Once you acquire a taste for his voice, I feel like you'll enjoy it a lot more. Jordan, I feel like there's not a lot of hope for, but I feel like you'll enjoy it a lot more, Jamie. But gotcha. he said in a podcast that his last album, the one that got released like last week, was mixed by
God.
But I forget the guy's name, but it was the guy who mixed Tyler the Creator's last album, which was cool.
Oh, DJ Drama.
Bro, no, he mixed it. Like he was like playing with the frequencies and stuff to make sure everything sounded really good, not like produced it.
Oh.
Gangsta Grip. Gangsta Grip.
I knew about Gangsta Girls before you got. See, Tyler put him on the map, but Gangsta Girls have been around for a really long time, even for like Jeezy and stuff. Lil Wayne even. I hate when people find music that I've been listening to. Or something.
Okay,
sorry. I started drinking coffee before the podcast. Dude, this is fun.
We should. Dude, why do I drink alcohol? I need to just.
Dude, morning pods low key hit a little bit.
I honestly like this. Yeah. I'm not sleepy.
I don't think like weekend mornings would be like. It's hard to be viable on the weekends because you know that's like when we plan shit. You know?
Right, that's when plans are happening. But it is fun whenever we do it.
Let's wake up before work and do it.
Oh hell no.
Jamie, you gotta wake up at 5
a.m. I just do it during work.
Oh, I would do it during work too.
I'll code in the background. Fucking
Nick would have to.
But yeah, I think.
Dude.
Tim Hill, new great album. And this dude named TV Girl. It's a guy. Not sure why he's named TV Girl. You might have heard some of his music on TikTok. I think the beginning of Lover's Rock is like a sound on TikTok. I can't place where I've heard it before, but it's either like a YouTube intro or TikTok or something, but I've definitely heard it before. But yeah, that's pretty much it. It made its way onto the Knicks mix. So.
Hey.
Hell yeah, dude. New is this week?
Yeah, this week, yeah.
Yeah. Nice. Dude, fucking I love live music things being on YouTube. If only for the fucking comments section.
Yeah.
Because I'm looking at Take On Me, the one we just talked about. The first comment, my wife loved the original version of this song. I just happened to stumble across this version a day after she passed on July 12th, 2022 at the tender age of 53. We played it at her funeral on July 20th. I believe this version is a gift for me to give to her. Rest in peace, my love.
Yeah, that's real?
Yes, bro. I think no, so.
Me too.
The next comment, the line slowly learning the life is okay hits like a truck in this rendition.
Dude, it's insane. It's a good song. It's a good rendition.
For like a couple of lines down, like 10 comments down, when I listen to this song in my mind, it's like I'm dancing with my daughter and her father. They were both murdered due to gun violence 16 years apart and died in the same hospital on the same floor, damn near the same room.
I'm not laughing at the content of that. I'm laughing that somebody would, like, it's good the that you absurdity. Can overshare, but that's very intense for...
It's, dude...
But the song's really good, though. The song's really good, though. Like...
I just can't have stop you been listening to this song, Damn You Deadpool 2. That's how that comment ends.
Oh, did Deadpool 2 play it?
I don't know, maybe. But like, it's insane. The comment sections for shit like this, and the voice is the same way. The voice blind auditions, unhinged trauma dumping in those comments. I'm like, this is shit you wouldn't tell to a therapist. But like, you're just throwing it out on the YouTube comment section.
Have you been listening to it in the background?
Or no? I listen to bits and pieces. I'll probably listen to the whole version.
How good is it? How good is it?
It's good. It's really good.
It's good. It's good. I know. Why not?
Yeah. But no, it's good. But I had to share just like, I know it's mean so much, but it is crazy. Like 50 to 60 year olds on YouTube comment section. It's fucking insane.
They're like, no one it'll will see like, this. This is just for me and my daughter.
It'll literally go to like, someone's like, oh, this is like really good. Like love from Brazil. And the next one's like, my daughter and husband died due to gun violence 16 years apart. This song reminds me that they're dancing together in heaven and someday I will join you too. Curse you, Deadpool 2. What the fuck? That's insane. It's so fucking funny. I mean, like the content's not funny, but it's just the absurdity of it.
Yeah.
It's like insane to me. I don't know. We all leave. It just goes to show, man, the people who leave comments, there's something
different
to breed. A little bit. They're a different breed. They're a different breed. Except for those of you who comment on our YouTube channel. Not you. You're not different.
You're actually beautiful. And you're beautiful. And you're lovely. I'm sure you're the life of the party.
You are. Jamie, listen, recent researching, whatever.
I already did mine. I started.
Oh.
You goof?
Yeah.
Why did that just fly over my head? What the fuck?
Yeah, the only thing left is to do the outro, I think.
Okay.
We just wanted to say thanks for listening this week and watching. If you did, remember to tune in next week for Like by Ice Spice. Also, once again, if you want to keep up with the show or share your thoughts about this week's episode, check out the socials. We are on Twitter @ListUp Podcast, Instagram and TikTok @ListenUpPod. Those accounts, as well as our personal handles, the merch links, the links to any show playlists, including the newest edition of Nick's playlist, Nick's Mix 20?
I think so.
Nick's Mix 20, the countdown.
Almost able to drink. So that's close. Exciting.
Two more weeks.
And then give it a couple weeks, and that playlist will be drunk as hell.
# legal.
But yeah, you can find all of those at the link tree in the social bios, and also in the description of wherever you found this episode. Finally, if you enjoyed this episode, if you could throw a rating or review on your respective platform our way, that would be fantastic. Share it with someone who gets really affected by seasonal depression.
And then YouTube won't make it worse.
No, definitely not. Our doom pilling will definitely not cause a spiral. Okay, never mind. Maybe don't do it. Give it to someone who's
really happy chipper, right now.
Really happy. Yeah. It'll level them out. And then YouTube, like, subscribe, notification bell if you want, because I've been pretty erratic about when I can edit. So.
But we thank Jamie. Everybody thank Jamie in the comments for editing our videos every week.
There you go.
He's the backbone of this corporation.
Other than that, we'll catch you next week, and remember to listen up.